Hello. It's a bit dark in here. Why does it feel so dark? I don't know why it feels. It feels really dark, but it's not dark. It's. Yeah, oh. Ugh. Right, show's over. Right, bye. Come on, Guthorm.
Stay in place.
Squishy's not having a problem. Just stay in place. He's going to fall over again. You wait. Let me put. Now Squishy's fallen over. God damn it. Right. Just.
You two, stop.
Hang on. I'm having
issues with my kids here. Just.
Like being a parent, it really is. Yes, hello, welcome everyone. Welcome. It is Sunday. It is the Warhammer Sunday. It is minus 438 degrees. I am freezing right now. I've got all the socks and all the pants and all the warms and my hoodie on and everything. So, by heck, it's cold. Welcome. It's Warhammer Sunday. It's that time of the week when I crack on building my backlog of Warhammer kits to get them ready for painting one future day. And I hang out with you guys at the same time and we have a laugh while I'm doing it. Today we're going to be cracking on with the Land Raider Crusader, because I've finished the Baneblade now, and I have started this already a little bit on Colin's show on Friday, so we'll crack on with that in a minute. But before we go anywhere, it's time for me to, first of all, get all the usual stuff done first and foremost. All the thank yous to all the people that make my content possible, to all my beautiful patrons and channel members, my patrons over at patreon.com/modelmakingguru, the address is there, and all my channel members who became channel members by clicking the join button underneath any one of my videos. Both of those groups support this channel each month financially, and they pay the bills, they keep food on my table, they make this channel possible to exist. Without them, I wouldn't be here at all. So massive thank you to them. Big thank you. Of course, if you want to help support the channel, you can become a patron at that address there or click on the join button. You get access to video content in a week in advance, advert-free, and some other perks as well. So have a look and see. It's always a good way to support the channel. Much appreciated. And of course, to my corporate supporters, emodels.co.uk and goblingaming.co.uk. Links to both those stores in the description below the video. They are your one-stop shop for all your tabletop and model making needs. Use those links that are down there if you need to pick stuff up. It tells them I sent you, and I get a little bit of commission for that. So thank you very much for using those. Doesn't cost you any more, but I really appreciate it. Anyway, welcome. Yes, let's crack on. Don't forget, of course, this is a typical one of my chats. We have the chat window there, the archive of it, which tends to fall over every 5 minutes. If you want to join the live chat, please do, because the whole point of these streams is for me to crack on with some work and you guys to have a good time in chat. So please do consider joining the chat. If you're watching this embedded in Facebook or Twitter or somewhere else, just click on the YouTube icon in the bottom right of the video player. That'll take you to YouTube, where you can carry on watching and you can join the live chat. If you're on a mobile device, you might need to scroll down below the video to see the chat there, but it's there somewhere. Anyway, let's have a quick look at who is in before we get going. We have Nim Cinderin is the first one in. Welcome, Nim, the Raging Modeler and Mayhem Model Works. They always appear at the same time. They're joined at the hip, them two. Nutters in cahoots. Raging Modeler and Mayhem are in. We've got William Rayborn's in. Welcome, William. Who's working on his F-91 Gundam while we're doing this. Wendy Hickson, one of my channel members. You can see Wendy's name's in green. She's got the little green guru icon. That means she's a channel member. She's pressed the join button and she's super awesome. So there you go. Thank you, Wendy, for your support. Wendy's in. Welcome. We have Dad at Scaly Models is one of your moderators, who's also a channel member. Dad's in and gets all the dad hugs. Massive hello to Dad. Dad and Colin and some of your other mods, Chris, they are moderators. They'll keep you safe in chat. Not that you need to, because it's really cool in my chat anyway. But if you do cross them, they'll cut you in half and feed you to the sharks after feeding you to the smaller sharks first. Then they'll feed those sharks to the bigger sharks, and then they'll feed those sharks to the army ants, and then they'll feed the army ants to the heart of the sun. So don't cross the moderators. I don't know where I was going with that. I got a bit carried away. Welcome, Dad. See what you made me do. Gemma Williams is in. Hey, Gemma, how are you doing? No sign of Chris yet, but Gemma's in. Welcome. We have... Candy Grand from Mongo is in. Welcome, Candy Grand, my friend. B3 is in. Steve's in. Hello, Steve. Lee Stevenson as well. Welcome to you. Colin at Festa 67's Workshop's in. Welcome. Colin's going to send Dad a Raspberry Pi and a camera for Psycam. Dad, Scaly Models, Dad has got this fish tank, and one of his fish is a complete and absolute nutter. It's a complete psycho and just bullied all the other fish, and they've just called it Psycho. I can think of some better names, but they've just called it Psycho. But welcome to Colin. Anybody who's just come from Colin and Dave's show, welcome. It was a good show today. Ray Aquilina from Malta is in. Hey, Ray. How are you doing, my friend? Hope you're having some good weather in Malta there. Edward Leonard is in. Welcome, Edward, my friend. We have Graham Robert. That will be Ted later on, falling over. Off on a crusade, stop touching things, says Mayhem and Raging. I don't know what we're talking about. Don't know what you've confused me, which is normal for them too. Panzer Koenig is in. Welcome, Panzer Koenig, another channel member. Welcome, welcome. Wayne Haywood says, hi all from the snowy West Mids. We haven't got any snow. William Rayburn's got a new cup of coffee and the compressor is fired up. Yes. The only problem with me doing any spraying while watching someone stream is I've got the compressor down under the bench and I've got the spray booth over there. I can't hear. If I can't watch someone stream at the same time because I can't hear them. But I might do. I've got to do some more spraying tonight. So today I've been working on the Goblin Gaming Orc Waz Bomb Dacajet thing. So I've got a layer of primer on it so far. My Mojo, if you're wondering why I've jumped onto the Waz Bomb Dacajet for Goblin and not finished the Lehman Russ yet, it's because my painting Mojo is just because I've not had chance to get to the bench for the last couple of months for various reasons, various real life reasons keeping me from the bench. It's really killed my mojo. It's just gone. So what I've done is I thought, well, I've got to film this for the guys at Goblin anyway. It gives me a deadline. I've mailed Tom at Goblin and said, hey, I'm starting to film this thing for you. I'll send you a link when it's done, which puts me in a corner and I can't get out of doing it. So it forces me to do some painting, even though my mojo is gone. And hopefully by the time I finished it, my mojo will have come back. So I thought it's a good way to get myself back into the saddle, is force myself back into the saddle. Because, you know, I know I've got a commitment to my patrons and channel members and everybody else to do painting, but it's getting your mojo back is really still a struggle. This way, I can't get out of it because I've told Tom I'm going to do it. So, yeah, we've got the primer coat down. Enormous cup of coffee. So I'll get that done this week, hopefully this week, next week. Then we'll crack on with the Lehman Russ because hopefully it'll get my mojo back up and running. So I forgot what I was talking about now. I was in the middle of talking about something. It's gone. It's completely gone. Yeah, we've got no snow here. So I can't hear people, but I've got to do some spraying tonight. That's what I was talking about. So I might see if I can listen to Ted's live stream tonight with my earpiece while I'm spraying, because then at least I can hear Ted and I can look at the screen when I need to. So I'll try that tonight, see if it works, because that's a problem. I can't watch stuff. I had to kind of rush to get stuff finished this afternoon, get the priming done before Colin started his stream with Dave, but I didn't get a chance, so I was kind of caught out and I had to miss a lot of Colin's stream, which was a pain. Anyway, yes, today we are working on the Land Raider Crusader, which I finished the Baneblade last week. Finished fettling with that. That's away, stored away in the box now. I've got myself a couple of plastic storage crates, so when I finish a build now, I can finish it, get it built, wrap it up in bubble wrap, put it in a poly bag so all the bits don't fall off, and then I can put it in a storage box. And then I've got them there, stored away, not taking up lots of space in my cabinets. And then I can leave them there till I get round to painting them. So, yeah, so everything's going quite nicely. Now, I did start this. I have started this, as you can see, when I joined Colin for his Insomnia stream on Friday night, which was great fun. I had real fun doing that. He was building his wonderful, wonderful Baneblade. And I needed something to do. So I started on my Land Raider Crusader, which my brother got me for Christmas, which is very nice. Thank you, my brother. So that's been, we've started on that. Some cleanup to do. Now, if you watched Friday's stream, you were up late. This door at the front here has got a top bit and a bottom bit, and it opens like that. Colin was most impressed by it because it's got this lever here. Chud Muppet here, some sponge sat on this chair at this bench, got a bit handy with the glue, and that doesn't open anymore. So I made a bit of a mess of that because I was going to paint the interior because that door could be open and I could get in there and I could paint it. But now that glue is sealed shut because my brain, you've basically got a rod here that pivots like this. And because it was like after midnight, it was like 2 a.m, my brain couldn't quite grasp the mechanics of this. And so I glued it in all the wrong places. And when I woke up the next day, I'm like, oh, wait. Oh, bums. Yeah. So I kind of glued this rod in place without thinking. So, yeah, that's now sealed permanently. But the thing is, that does tend to fall off, so I'm not sure if you didn't glue that, how it would stay in place. You'd have to come up with a much more sturdy mechanism. It's a very nice mechanism. These two bits rotate and make the arm go like that. And when you pull the top one open, the bottom one opens. It's quite nice. But anyway, it's permanently sealed now, so there's no point me painting the inside, because I could technically paint the inside, but you're never going to see it. So I'm just going to build it. There you go. We're going to crack on with this. Now, it does raise a question with these things, these Land Raider Crusaders, all these Space Marine vehicles. As it stands at the minute, I haven't got any kind of Space Marine forces. And what I have got is Primaris. I've got a small number of old style Marines, and mostly all the ones I have got, like some Space Wolves and stuff. Rare Aquilina says, sorry guys, I've got to go and make tea. Go make tea, my friend. See you soon. Thank you for coming in. So I've only got mostly Primaris Marines. Now, these old transports, which are from the old times, when you play the game now, Primaris Marines can only go in Primaris transports. They can't go in old-style transports for some fluff reason that nobody really knows. So it makes you wonder, if somebody's just buying Space Marines now and only using Primaris, they can't buy any of, they can't use any of these old vehicles. They're not usable. So it does make you wonder, what's the point? I mean, there can't be, I mean, I suppose there are lots of people with old-style Marines, but it is a bit fractury, isn't it? I know there's a lot of lore reasons, and I know the lore behind it, but still. They need some more vehicles for the Primaris Marines, because I'm going to mostly have Primaris Marines, and I still haven't figured out how to pronounce Primaris or Primaris, so you'll see me, you'll hear me saying it a million different ways. But this is old school, old Space Marine vehicle, so let's crack on. So we've built the superstructure, not the superstructure, the chassis structure. There's not a very particularly complicated build, this, I don't think. There's not a lot to it, so now we're not doing the interior, because it's got some lovely engine detail at the back here and lots of internal stuff, and it would be nice to paint it, because my idea was that I'd have that open. You could have that, you could open it up and it would, you'd see inside, or you could lift the top off. But yeah, you need to come up with a way of making that more secure joint. I was wondering why you're gluing that. I think when you put the outer piece on, it keeps it from falling out, says Edward. I did wonder that, actually, after the fact. Let me get me bits. Because after the fact, it does, that piece goes on there, I think, like that. It, and there's a little detent there. Now I've seen it, there's a little thing there that stops it sliding out. Now I've seen that, I know that. And there's one there as well, look. Because I was playing with it, saying, oh, look, it works, but it keeps falling off. If I'd known that, and thought ahead, I could have, yeah. So next time I build one of these, if I build another one of these, yeah, I'll know that now next time. What can I say? I'm special. I'm super special. I'm super special. Anyway. A scaly model says, sorry to hi to every, say, I'll say again. Sorry, hi to everyone I've missed, because somebody asked if the asked question has been answered. I'll start again. Well, hang on, let me have a swig of coffee. Yeah. There we go. Right, I'm just talking rubbish now. Now, Dad says, sorry, hi to everyone who I've missed. I've been busy after a psycho fish. It's still free to roam. Humph. Yeah, she doesn't know what to do with this fish that's hassling all the other fish. Right, so we built that. So we've got some bits to do. So we'll crack on. Anyway, we'll get on with this. Huggy Draw Around says, Dad, remember them thumbs, folks. Thank you very much, Colin. Yes, don't forget, of course, to give this video a thumbs up or thumbs down if you don't enjoy it. Giving a thumbs up to the content you like means that content gets listed better in the YouTube search engine and helps your favourite channels get noticed. So always do a thumbs up. That's what instructions are for, you spoon. The instructions simply, they say not to glue it, which is fine. Yeah, but it doesn't specifically state anywhere that this is prevented from falling out. And I put it together with no glue and was playing with it, but it kept pinging off and I'm like, well, that's rubbish. I'll glue it in such a way that it's not going to fall off, but it still moves. But because it was 2 a.m, I kind of misthought it and it went wrong. Shut up now. I've stopped listening now. Right, so let's get some bits glued on. I can't help being special, can I? I can't help it. You wouldn't like me if I was not special. Now, because this is an oldie worldie kit, 1999, this kit, none of the parts are numbered, of course. But it's not particularly complicated. Right, Ray's back. He's got some tea. Yay! Put more glue on, then pull it off. I don't know. Probably won't work. Put my lenses on so I can see. Don't forget, of course, once I've got these lenses on, which I have now, all this will become blurred. All the chat here will be blurred completely. So if you want to catch my attention, please do. Give me things to talk about. If you want to catch my attention and make sure that I see your comment, please put your comment in capital letters. Put the whole thing in capital letters so I know it stands, so I can see it stands out. Or if you want to, you can do a super chat. And all you need to do is press the little dollar symbol at the bottom of the chat window. That puts your comment in a big coloured box and means there's no way for me to miss it because it shows up on the chat there. It also helps support this channel at the same time. It's another way you can help keep this channel alive by doing super chats. That's a piece of old sprue now. I can throw that away. It's another way for you to help support this channel as and when you want to. It keeps the channel alive, and I do appreciate the support, because without it, I would just, this channel just wouldn't exist. I wouldn't have the time to do video content at all if I couldn't do this as a day job. So I do massive thank you to all my supporters. See, there's all this detail. I'm just like, got like, oh, you've got like a tow rope and winches and tools, and you've got like computer screens and stuff. All this beautiful detail that's going to go here, which would be seen if I could do it with the doors open. But I've not, because I messed that up. So, yeah. Deep sigh. But don't forget, of course, you can also at me in the chat, at Model Making Guru. Mayhem says, when I built a Land Raider and left the bit loose after a time, it wiggled loose and was a pig to fix. Yeah, because if that does come loose, once this bit's stuck on, this is the thing, you see. This is the thing I'd considerate with my thinking brain. Once you put this on, once you line this up, once you're not an idiot and you can get it done, once you... Oh, come on, Fox, it's holes and put... There we go. Once this is on there, I've still got it wrong. Once that goes on there anyway, you have the track here, and it's a completely sealed unit. You can't get in there. So if that does come off, you're knackered. You can't get to it. It's locked away behind the tracks. So, yeah... You can leave the side ramp down or up. Cool. Or I could magnetize it, I suppose. I could do some funky magnetizations. Perhaps. Because I like my magnet thing now, you see. I like my magnets now. I'll see what I can do with it. Get these cleaned up. 1999 kit, mold lines and flash galore, says Raging Modeler. Absolutely, I found flash on this. I've never had flash on a Warhammer kit before, on a Games Workshop kit. Because I thought this was a relatively new model, you see. I didn't realise it was like 21 years old. I'm like, wow. Because it's got the modern packaging. And some of the old kits, they haven't yet got round to updating the packaging. So it's got modern instructions and everything. It's quite disturbing. But I'm not going to complain, because I got this for free, because my brother got it as a Christmas present for me. So thank you very much. And even if I do have just Primaris Marines, I can still use it as a, not as a transport, but as a, I suppose I could still use it as an offensive capability vehicle. Scaly Models, £5. Hello from Psycho, says Dad. Thank you very much, Dad. That's very, very kind of you. That's what a super chat looks like. You can see it there. I can't miss them. Thank you very much, Dad. You're very, very kind. Hello, Psycho, you mad, glorious, insane creature. Yeah, Dad's being driven spare by this fish. He says they're all tetra fish or whatever, or tetra things, you know, average fish. But I don't know. I think perhaps he's accidentally bought some kind of like psycho Japanese fighting fish and put it in with a load of tetras. Are they called tetras? I don't know fish. We had fish when we were a kid, but it was a tank full of fish that went black because we never cleaned it out. And they all survived for years and years and years in this black water somehow. I think they all mutated. Some of the Orc, Eldar and Tyranid models have updated since haven't some of the Orc, Eldar and Tyranid models have had update since 3rd edition. I think you mean haven't had updates. Yeah, there's a lot of old models out there, and there's no reason to redo them. If there's a model of a specific vehicle, then there's no reason to make a new one of it. Like, if you want a Land Raider, why would they re-release a brand new Land Raider? There's no point. I know they're not going to make any new vehicles for the old style Marines now. I think any vehicles they do make will be Primaris focused. The thing is, there'll be lots of people out there with old style Marines, so they're not going to stop making the old vehicles. I think the problem is, you know, there'll be somebody out there who'll buy a squad of Primaris Marines and like three or four of these, and then suddenly find when they get them all built and painted and try to play them on the table, they'll be like, oh, you can't use those with those. Oh. Bet you. I bet there's people that get suckered by that and suffer because of it. Bet there are. That's a bit underhand. Right, so this goes in here like this, you'll see. Now, there are some little ejector pin marks there. I don't know if this will even be left open. But on the off chance that it does get left open, or I can magnetize it in some way, because this will, I was going to say this will get sold, but it's a Christmas present, so I can't really sell it. I'll flatten these down. Now, thankfully, I think they are raised pin marks, or slightly, not too badly recessed. They're not too hard to clean up. So, yeah. Anyway, let's crack on with the conversation. How is everyone? I hope you're all well. I hope everybody's doing okay. I hope some of you have had some nice, lovely snow. We had a little bit of fluffy snow the other day that was about 2 inches deep, and then within 2 hours it had gone. We really can't do snow here. We just suck at doing the snow thing. We used to get some great big snowdrifts when I was a kid. When I was a lad, it was great. Now we don't get anything. Right, chat just jumped, so let me have a look at that in a minute. I need to clear my throat. Hang on. There we go. I like to give you the wiggly hand so you know I'm still here. Do, 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 do. Yes, I hope everyone is okay and doing all right. No great news from my end, as always. Although, you know, I have actually managed to get a little bit of work done this week. I have done some on the, like I said, the priming on the Orc Flyer, which we'll be filming hopefully throughout the course of this week coming up. Had a very jolly time, like I say, on Colin's channel on Friday for his Baneblade build. I don't know if we're doing another one this week. I assume we are, or we'll be doing another one anyway as he carries on with it. I don't know if that'll be this week or basically whenever Cole wants to do one. Do one. Just rescribing this little panel line here that I slightly sanded flat. That was jolly good fun. I'm not sure what else has been going on this week. Not a lot, really. It has been frustrating these last couple of months, just because, best intentions aside, real life really has just gotten in the way, and I've just had so little time to do anything at the bench. Like when I had to film that little armoured car for E-models, he said, could you do a quick review and build of this kit? And I'm like, can I... But I managed to get it done in a couple of days. It was only a real quick paint job there, a real basic quick paint job. So that I was lucky in that when it came at just exactly the right moment for me to get that done. So, but yeah, I'm hoping that by doing this Orc Flyer now, pausing on the Lehman Russ and doing the Orc Flyer, it just gets my mojo back. My mojo's only vanished because I've not been able to get to the bench, and it's kind of the frustration that sets in because I've not been able to get to the bench. A little bit rough around the edges there. I think it'll be fine once it's got primer and paint on it then. Oh, excuse me. But I hope you're all well. Hope everyone's doing okay. You've not had any particularly bad weather. Hope you've all managed to avoid the flooding that we've had here in the UK. You're staying safe. I think that's looking... Yeah, it's not looking great. Hang on. You can't really see the recess bits now, but I know as soon as I put primer on that, you'll see them. They're subtle enough that you can't see them in bare plastic. But you put primer on that and you will know. You will see them. Oh, yes. I have to give them some credit for the sculpts on these things, considering this was before they did the Primaris thing. What was that? Oh. It'll pop through in the chat in a moment. Hang on. For some reason, I'm getting the audio cue for Super Chats and stuff before actually getting the thing in Super Chat, which is really in chat, which is weird. Come on. Come on. You can do it. Wow. Is my chat just fallen over? Entirely possible. Hang on a minute. Hang on a minute. Pressing some buttons. It's not. Come on. Well, I don't know. I don't know why it's not popped through, but I saw it briefly on screen. I think it was Colin. I think it was Fester. Put a super chat through. I'm guessing now because it's not updating my chat for some reason. Oh, there we go. Finally. Oh, it got backlogged. £5 of super chat from Colin for being you. Well, thank you very much. You give me money for being an idiot. I like that. Thank you. Thank you very much, Colin. That's very, very kind. Apologies, it took a second there. I think the chat got backed up. Does that sometimes. But thank you very much, Colin. That's very, very kind of you. When Fox said you didn't know what to do with that, I did almost suggest a good batter recipe. I'll talk about the fish. Tetratude. It's a tetra with attitude, or tetratude. Yeah. Now, I'm now wondering what the oldest model that's still in production might be, asks Candygram. They still do quite a few metal kits. If you look on Games Workshop's website, they've still got a lot of the old Iron Legion, you know, they're like Cadian Troopers, but they're not, they're more, I can't remember what they're called now, like the Iron Troops, Shock Commandos, they're metal. They still do the old, I think they've still got the old metal Sisters of Silence. So there's quite a few old metal kits out there. They're really old. They've still got things like the really crappy Orc helicopter, the Defcopter, which is obviously garbage. They're doing all those things. A lot of the Orc stuff's quite old. Ollie's doing a Raspberry Pi cam. God help us. I went to work on Friday night clear, says Panzer. Sky is not a cloud to be seen. 9 hours later, heading home. Snow. Yes. I would be excited if it snowed, but I live in an area that's so flat, the highest feature is the pavement. Yeah, we're the same, really. Had snow here, says Sarah Jane. Hey, Sarah Jane. It's melting fast. Colin, the man with the biggest heart in the universe, that says Mayhem Model Works. This is true. This is true. Plastic Monkey. Ooh, Plastic Monkey, thank you very much. £5 super chat. Hi, Fox. Hi, Plastic Monkey. Hello, my friend. How you doing, my friend? Frankie goes, Hobby Wood is in. Hello, Fox and everyone. Hello, Frankie. Phil East is in as well. Hi, Phil. How you doing, my friend? Thank you very much for that, Plastic Monkey. You're very, very kind. I think YouTube is being an arse, says Raging Modeler. Yeah, it probably is. Do-do-do-do-do-do. Now, as Colin was saying on his show earlier on, if you're watching it, and if you weren't watching it, why? Sort that crap out right now. If you're watching it, you mentioned the Boomhut Modcast, which, if you remember, back in the olden times, when we used to have the Model Makers Treehouse Club, we had the Model Makers Treehouse live stream. The Treehouse is long gone, that doesn't exist anymore. But we do have the Model Makers Boomhut Modcast, and we've done a couple of them. Most notably the one where Colin disappeared under his desk and we all helped by laughing at him. I would say with, not at, actually with. Laughing with him, let's just say. We were very helpful. We were very helpful in that way. And yeah, well, I've been wanting to get back to the modcast for quite a while, but the demise of Google Hangouts caused a lot of problems with that. Like Colin was saying, I've been learned in the way of StreamYard. So, hopefully, it'll be a situation where we can actually start doing some more modcasts. Oh, there's openy doors. Yeah, we'll keep them closed, though, I think, because what does that sit over the top? I think it just plonks down, doesn't it? Yes, with StreamYard, we can start looking at doing some more Model Makers Boomhut moderator casts and things like that, which would be awesome. See, I could have the doors open. They kind of stop like that, but they're going to fall out again, aren't they? I'm just going to have sadness when they all fall out. Yeah, we'll just keep them closed. We'll just keep them closed. Yes, anyway, so I have StreamYard. Yeah, we could do some moderator cast type things. But the problem with StreamYard I'm having is, and I don't know why, but for some reason, it's only me that has this issue. But for some reason, whenever I use, when I'm in StreamYard, I fall out. It can be after an hour or 10 minutes. Basically, you sign into StreamYard and you start your streaming activities. And then, without warning, I'll just be kicked back to the click here to join button screen. That's where the button where you join the you know, it says check your microphone and you press. It's not logging me out of the app completely. It's just pushing me back to the please click this button to join this, the Hangout thing. And it's really annoying. I mean, I don't know why. Nobody else has that problem. And it's not every single time. It's occasionally. But the problem is, of course, because I've got to do the eModel show tomorrow. I'm doing all the button pressing in StreamYard tomorrow. And if it happens, basically, it's not a problem when I'm a guest in StreamYard and somebody else is hosting it, because then I just come back in again. But when I've got all the buttons, what you'll get is the stream will be going and then you'll get a white screen with the login button. And then I'll log in. It'll last a second or two. But, yeah, it's going to be really annoying. So it might be a case that we do them, but perhaps, for example, Colin or somebody else might have to do the StreamYard bit. Because if I fall out as a guest, it doesn't matter. But if I fall out as the person doing the stream, then it's white screen of death for everybody, which is really annoying. We'll see. But yes, I do want to do more boom hook modcasts. It's simply a situation at the minute. It's simply a case of getting everybody together in the same place and finding a slot to do it that doesn't, I don't know where that went, finding a slot to do it that's not causing problems for somebody else's streams. I do want to do more because they were jolly good fun. It's a good thing to give to the people in the mod, in their boom hut, the hair on there. Ew! I'm hoping it's one of my hairs. At this point, you could go either way. We need the other side piece. Ew, we missed the side piece. Reggie Modeler says, hang on, no. Frankie Ghost Hobo says hello to everybody. Yep, we did that one. Somewhere I have a metal second edition Eldor Uthran still in its packaging, says Lee Stevenson. Wow, that'd be worth a bit. I've got some. Tony over at Helgen 35 sent me some Kasakin commandos. They're like the Imperial Guard guys, but they're metal. The Kasakin, I think they're called. Because I didn't know what they were at first. I thought they were just like Imperial Guard, but they're not the Kasakin. And apparently they're quite valuable, but he'd already painted them and stuff, so they were worth like nothing. Only joking, Tony. So I've got them somewhere. I've got them to paint out. Oh, wow. Yeah, that's quite tightly attached. Matron. Was pricing up the Rogue Trader 2nd Edition Orc Battle Wagon on eBay. Yeah, no. I'll dig out an old white dwarf where it's got the plans and build it from plastic card. Wow. It may be a firewall port doing some packet inspection and then closing the streaming port down, dropping the stream, says Lee Stevenson. Could be. That's lots of words that I know what they know what they mean individually, but no idea what they mean as a sentence. But and I kind of know what you mean. But it doesn't give me any problems with any other. Like, I don't have the problem with this stream when I'm streaming through anything else. Really frustrating. I'm assuming it's just some sort of thing with StreamYard being quite sensitive to it or something. I don't know. Really annoying. I tried looking it up online, but I've not found anything that tells me how to fix it. Tall, so yeah, it's really frustrating, quite annoying. Wow, you can tell these are old molds. The quality of the plastic's not as great as normal. There's little stripes and marks all over it, like very rough plastic. You can see all sort of texture in it. It's like, oh dear, that's not cricket. So I'd love to do like Colin's doing the stream with me, and he does the Sunday stream with Dave. I'd like to occasionally say make one of these Warhammer Sundays, like me and somebody else having a bit of a laugh. But of course, unless they can do the StreamYard, it means it's going to fall over. And because the problem I've got is I'm sat here, I'm facing the iPad, the microphone there, spray booth there, camera here, my computer's over behind me to the right. So I don't necessarily know if the stream falls over. That's the problem. Like on a Monday night, I'm looking at the screen so I can see when the stream falls over. If I'm doing something like this from the workbench, I don't know. When I was with Col on Friday, I kind of knew when I'd fallen out because Colin wasn't laughing at a joke or wasn't replying to a comment. But I was still a bit of a lag. But if I was hosting a stream, I wouldn't know. And you guys would be looking at a white screen for 10 minutes until somebody in chat said, stream's falling over, and I'll be like, oh crap, there's at least half a minute, so I don't know. It's kind of frustrating in a way, because I'm not technically minded enough to figure that nonsense out, so yeah. I normally just look online and hope somebody else has had the problem and knows how to fix it. which is usually the solution I get end up with. Not found anything yet for StreamYard. I'll figure it out at the end, I'm sure. Like this, like when I found, you know, remember when I used to do streams every Saturday and Sunday about 3 o'clock after about half, well, it used to get to about half three and my stream would fall over. And that was really frustrating. It was making me think I couldn't do streaming. And it turned out that was Windows updates being not scheduled by me. It was just like the default time because I hadn't specified a time for Windows to look for updates and antivirus updates. Because I hadn't specified a time, Windows picked one at random and it happened to be half three on a Saturday and Sunday. And that was just, and I figured that out in the end. I was like, oh, so I just had to basically build in some, tell the system when to do some checks. And then I also figured out that what I could do is just turn off auto updates as well. So when I've got a stream coming up, I go into Windows and I physically turn off auto updates and check, so it doesn't check for updates. And then I have to remember to unpause it again afterwards. So yes, but I didn't really know what I was doing. I was just kind of reading things on the internet and thinking, well, I could try that. As long as somebody's got an idiot guide to do it, I should be all right. But the StreamYard thing has kind of frustrated me a little bit. Because I'd love to make occasionally this Sunday stream, I'd like to make Warhammer Sunday occasionally, you know, two people. Get a couple of us doing it. Just have a guest. Like either Ted or Chris or somebody, I don't know. Or Carl or whoever wants to join in. Of a Sunday. It'd be quite nice. Get a bit of a rapport going on. But at the minute, it's not something I can do. I mean, I could do it with Chris and I could do it with Cole, because both Cole and Chris know I've got StreamYard. I could take over the StreamYard side of it. Ted's got access to StreamYard, and he's at the moment he's still figuring it out. So eventually, it might be something that Ted could do. So those three I could do, and I could get them to do the StreamYard bit and just push it to my channel. But anybody else, I'd be like, you can't. No. We'll see. We'll see how it goes. I like to do some joint Sunday streams every now and then. Because I love doing this by myself, you know, on a Sunday. It's quite nice to have a chat with you guys. But there are times it is good fun when you do a stream with somebody else. And, you know, I had a great time on Friday. I had a really great time with Colin on Friday. And it's like, oh. I do look a little bit jealousy at him and Dave on the Saturday morning, Saturday lunchtime. Because they have such a good time. And then there's me afterwards on my own here. I'm like, oh. And I've got the sniffles. So, yeah, I'd like to do some more. Not all the time, but just I'd like to have the option of having someone come along and join me. That'd be nice. Right, so that goes there, like there. Trust it. Fantabulous, yeah. That will sit in there like that. There, it will sit in there like that. I think, yes. Like that. Kaplink. So that sits in there. Look at those beautiful little... Yeah. I want to pick. Ooh, there's a little jackhammer and there's a thing with the bits. I want to paint those. I'll get them glued on. The other doors that go on the outside. This is where I could potentially show off that. Is with cunning magnetizationals. Because it's a simple door that slots in. Just a door that slots in there. There's a potential there for me to magnetate a little door so that if I wanted to have it openable, could do. I just want to paint those bits inside, but if I'm going to glue the door over, there's no point doing that. And then it would be a real pain to then play on the table and have the door open. Yeah, maybe I'll just glue the door. I don't know. We'll see. Right. Get these side pieces glued on. There's a lot to do before then anyway. Let us attach these parts. Gentlemen, attach your parts. This is going to be dead simple, this. We're going to use the fat glue for this. Remember, Tamiya regular cement, it's the fat viscous glue. I don't need to use extra thin. By the time I've got extra thin on all these posts and work my way around, it'll have evaporated off. So what I'll do is I'll just quite simply get some extra thin on the posts. I mean, get some regular fat cement, which doesn't fade away. It won't actually flash off like extra thin. So I can just generously splob it on like that. Hopefully on camera. Get it on. There you go. Get those in there. Line them up. Nice and shiny. And then we can come in with the extra thin. Just toughen that up. The extra thin, it is a stronger grip. It welds better than the fat viscous cement. It goes in by capillary action. But it does flash off very quickly, and it's not really... not got any tensile strength. It's not going to hold things in place very easily. So, not with the fat. That's that on. There was a post in the Boom Hut the other day, somebody asking about what cements to use. And I would say the bare minimum, if you're working with polystyrene kits, a bare minimum cement is a fat cement like Tamiya Extra Thin. This is like the Citadel cement or Revell Contactor glue. It's just fat and gloopy. Get yourself a fat cement and get Tamiya Extra Thin. Or there's also an ammo by make version of this. Tamiya Extra Thin. One just goes on by being sticky and gloopy and fat, and this one works by capillary reaction. So you put two things together, you touch the glue, and the glue goes into the gap and it melts the plastic and welds them together. Most of the time I'll use the extra thin because I can use it to make very clean joins. Sometimes I use the fat for other reasons. I need to glue this on the side on. Have a look at the chat in a second. But yes, I hope you're all well. Hope everyone's okay. Not a lot of news from my end, anyway. Has Dad asked the question? I assume Dad's asked the question. I've just not noticed it in chat. So, have you asked the question, Dad? I assume you have. Probably have just missed it. Because I've missed a lot of chat, so. I know you've been a bit distracted with the psycho fish, so. Come on, get him. Quite line up perfectly, but you have to, a bit of persuasion, and it'll go in. I know I'm not on camera. Yeah, go on, in you, there you go. Good lad, good lad. Bench and belly for me. Bench, of course, is this. And belly tonight, don't know. I said to Mama Fox, basically go in the freezer, pick something out that you want for dinner. Now this comes with two possibilities. One, she'll just be dead lazy and not be bothered and just say, let's have a takeout. Or she will actually do the one thing I asked of her and she'll go in, have a look in the freezer. I'm going to have to tape this because that wants to ping out. So let me get some big fat tape. And then we'll have a look at the chat for a minute. Oh, hang on. Big fat tape. Big tape, big fat tape. The tape was fat and it was really blue and it went on there and I don't know who. I was trying to make up some amusing lyrics then and totally didn't. Yeah, it seems to be wanting to ping out a little bit, so I think a little bit of tapularity might be required here. Just to give it a minute to clamp together. Be a lot easier if I had big fat clamps for it. Big fat clamps. Big fat clamps. But I don't, so. Yeah. So we'll leave that for a minute. Yeah, these are kind of pinging apart a little bit, which I don't really want when I've got to put tracks on there. What you don't want is things going like that. Right, where's chat up to? Has Dad asked the question? I don't know. Reggie Modeler says to Phil East, I guess he's saying about the orc truck, and he says, well, he doesn't say that because that was just me burping. He says, yes, but I love the look of the old battle wagon. I do like the orc battle wagon, it's quite cool. I remember watching the stream where Colin fell off his chair, laugh. I was on the floor in a pool of water struggling to breathe with a sore leg. He says, Panzer, it was hilarious. Temporal techno babble anomaly, says Lord High Bobbins. Hey, Lord High Bobbins. I hate Windows Update causes so many issues for me. Yeah, if you don't know how to turn Windows Updates off or pause them, literally hit the Windows icon on your taskbar so the thing pops up. I don't know the words. And just type Win, Windows Update Settings, and it'll give you the option right there. It'll say pause for 7 days. Pause it for 7 days. If you do any kind of live streaming, I recommend you pause it for 7 days. All it means is at the end of 7 days, it'll unpause and then it'll download any updates, any security updates and things like that. But what I tend to do is pause updates, do my live stream, finish the live stream, close everything down, and then go back into and then unpause it again, because you need your security updates and stuff like that. But I also had to go into various other places and change script and change things in the settings, like antivirus updates and stuff. Basically, if you don't tell Windows when to look for security updates, it will just pick a random time and do that time every day. So, yeah, bit of rubbish when you're streaming. Because if you do a Windows update and you're doing a stream, it can either kill your stream because it resets the system or because it chews up your processor. My streams are falling over because it was pushing my processor over 100%. Yes. Where are we? Sorry about the coughing. I spent an hour this morning, says Raging Modeler, shopping for a new iMac and upgrading it. It's going to happen in the summer. £2,500. It's for music, not gaming. Wow. Can you not buy an equally powerful PC for a lot less than £2,500? Is that not like a really expensive thing to do? Do you need a new one? Is your one knackered? Yeah, I mean, isn't that like... you not get the same kind of setup for less on a PC? I don't know. On the subject of old model kits, has anyone ever come across the Pat Labor 160 soft dementation models? Got given some. I wonder if me painting them will be the repriming the Mona Lisa. I know there's the 160 scale Pat Labors with the rubber tubing to go around the joints and stuff. No, go for it. Have fun with it. What's on your bench and what's in your belly, folks? Says Dad. There you go. Yeah. So what's on your bench? What are you working on right now? It's not a model. Could be a drawing or a picture. Or you could be doing a diamond art. Or could be anything. You could be crafting something from wood. You could be making something hewn from the finest marble. I don't know what you're doing. Anything crafty. What you're doing. And what's on your what's in your belly? What you're going to have for your dinner, or what have you had for your dinner? Where are we to? I hate window. I've done that one. Oh, all vinyl parts. Oh, that might not be the one I'm thinking of then. EC Idaho's in. Welcome, EC Idaho. He says, I have a very old vinyl or resin LED, lead Mirage mech will never build. I've got... somebody got me from Telford the other year. They got me a vinyl Odo. Like, you know, 1/6 scale figure that I must have built at some point. But it's dealing with vinyl. You have to, like, fill it with... plaster or something to bulk it out, otherwise it just collapses in on itself. Bench is detail painting my friend's ATST, says Nim, and belly has yet to be decided. I'm gonna guess noodles or Arby's or whatever the burger thing you have is. I mean, noodles are a burger, isn't it? And you're doing a little commission bill for your friend. Cool. It's okay, Dad, the fish has distracted you, says Nim. Sorry, Nim, he says, because he forgot the question. It's not just me needling you this time. He plays when I ask the question, but then when he's given free rein to do it, he forgets to do it. I don't know. It's that fish, Dad. You've got to sort that fish out. Give it its own tank. where are we up to? It has, it is true, says Dad. EC Idaho, Benchmaster Grade 1/100th Ground GM. Jolly good. That's a really... steady. A good kit, that. Yeah, Cole's done one of those. It's a really nice kit and begs for like urban camo and things like that. It's a really nice build. Ground GM. Belly cheddar Kaiser roll with pepperoni. Ooh, yeah, Spruglu addict. What's in your fish tank and will it be in your belly? Says Spruglu. There's an alternative. Yes. Dad's new question. What's in your tank and how can you kill it? Panzer says Bench is a Mong BUK anti-aircraft missile. Belly just scoffed a pizza. Now Panzer Koenig. Finger. Not the finger of shame, but it's the finger of explaining. It's the finger of... you know how this works. You can't just say pizza. You can't just do that. We want all the filthy details, because you have to remember, when it comes to bench and belly, we don't really care about the bench. We just ask that out of politeness. It's the belly we want to talk about. We want to know all the filth, all the tiny little details. That's an ELO reference, Dad. You won't get that, maybe. But you want all the food fill. Tell us about the plastic kit. So you can't just say pizza. We need to know what kind of pizza and what topping. So we shall wait while you provide all the extra details that you missed out. We'll let you off this time. You know. Raging Modeler, Bench, Chaos Lord, Auric, Megaboss, and Gretchen with more orcs to build. Belly Crumpets. You don't need to really explain on Crumpets. So we can. He's allowed that one. Muse is in. Hey Muse, how you doing, my friend? Bench, need to pick something from the shelf of partially done things. Belly coffee as soon as I drag myself to make it. Mayhem says nub. Chris at Gross Models is in, says hello YouTube. Hello Chris, how you doing, my friend? Chris is another one of your mods, of course. We'll keep you safe, but we'll burn you alive with a cigarette lighter if you cross him. Chris, Bench is a random mess of stuff and belly is not yet filled properly, says Phillies. Then you need to fill it properly. There's only two ways for a belly to be: filled properly or in the process of being filled properly. Everything else is wrong. Oh, hi Fox, says EC, I know. I'll just carry on. You know that moment when you're seesawing through a broken Nerf gun and sort of zone out and not realise how far you're along, and then you cut a slice out of your finger? Yep. That's me, says B3. Ooh, get a plaster on that, dude. Get it rinsed out, because you don't want plastic particles in your blood. That's dangerous. Get it properly flushed out and get it. Tell you, there's nothing more painful than when you cut yourself and you've got to flush it out with some water. You put your finger under the tap and it's like, what? Really bad. But yeah, if you are cutting plastic, or especially, well, absolutely if you're cutting resin, but if you are cutting plastic or anything like that, and you've been sanding and you cut yourself, please make sure you properly flush out the wound. It sounds really silly to say it, but the last thing you want is non-soluble plastic bits and debris going into a wound, because if it gets into your bloodstream, it can't be broken down by the body, it's in your bloodstream, and that's very dangerous. So whenever you're sawing or cutting and you've got dust flying around, always rinse it out properly. You've seen me stab myself and put super glue in there and stuff. I've not been sawing and sanding at the time, but you just be careful. You can, but for some reason everyone who's used PC for music has had issues, says Raging Modeler. I have no thoughts on that matter. On my bench is the diorama. Belly tonight is a lovely gammon joint. Oh, but we need to know what you're hamming with the gammon. You know the rules, Chris. You're not just having a plate with a piece of gammon on it. All the information, please. And a pineapple or no pineapple. I'm fine. It's very shallow and hardly any claret. All dressed up and it's not bleeding anymore. Yeah, he says B3. Wendy says, belly roast chicken cooking, bench making a mess. Yes. Ghost Lyle is in. Says, hello, pineapple, 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 pineapple. Of course. I agree completely. Lord High Bobbins has primed a whole battleship and belly tonight is stir fry. Need the details. Can't just say stir fry. I want stir fry now. It's got its own tang. Just can't catch it to put it in there, says Dad. You wrote Psycho the Fish. Bench is mostly claret stained plastic, lol, and belly will be roast chicken and all the trimmings. Yes. Wayne Haywood says, bench dread minis, belly prawn soaked in vinegar and salt with bread and butter. Ooh, yeah. Sound like that. Nice and simple, but dead delicious. I think it might have been a kid. You used to get like a bag of frozen prawns and you just get them out, thaw them out and get them in some dressing and some bread and butter and that'd be nice. Gemma says, food later will be gammon with whatever Katie chooses to do, as well as I'm doing a 1,000-piece waz jig. Oh, I see, waz is the wrong way. It's a jigsaw. It's a waz-gidge. Waz-gidge. Is that a brand of jigsaw? Waz-gidge. Is it a backwards jigsaw? If it goes wrong, fish supper, says Sprue to Dad. And I have a mug of coffee and a pack of 10 Thornton's chocolate fudge brownies. No, wait, 9. Oops, 8, says Panzer. This is correct. Somebody send Dad a rod and reel. In fact, most human beings have microplastics in their bodies due to microplastics now in the food chain, says Mayhem. This is true. Belly will be roast chicken, says Edward. Ooh. Underdog paintings in. Hey, Underdog, just striped and resprayed my Death Guard army ready to paint. Yes. Oh, stripped. It's a stripe there. Yeah, stripped and resprayed my Death Guard ready to paint. Yes. Death Guard. I've got a million Death Guard to paint. I got all my Death Guard from the Warhammer Conquest thing. I've got all those guys to paint yet. Now, do I take this off now, or is it going to ping apart? I don't know. Let's see what the next step is first. I know what I do need to do, actually. While I'm waiting for that to clear my throat, first of all. There we go, much better. While I'm waiting for that, I need to clean up the mould line on these exhausts that I didn't clean up when I put them together. Have you seen Ninjon's Death Guard paint like the box art video, says Mayhem, the underdog. I haven't seen that. I'm going to clean up these little exhausts on the back. Just give them a quick clean up with the scrape it on tool. Because it would be a nice little fine seam line, but there's a big step there because the pieces didn't really fit together very well. But thankfully, with a good dollop of glue in there, I can just scrape them smooth. Scrape it smooth. This is correct. Knife on that one, I think, because it's a bit too small. Oh, hello. I dropped my ring. Hey, yay. Hey. Just file those from above. These, I think it's going to be easier if I do it that way. I've got kind of the wrong angle here, but all I did was when I put these together, I made sure I splooged the glue out. So you get the little gap is filled by the glue splooging the melted plastic out. Very rare. I can't remember the last time actually I had to use putty, filler putty. I really can't remember at all. Because 99% of the time, you don't need it. Sometimes you do. Sometimes you don't. I'm having a bit of trouble with this now. I'm just trying to file away. Really, all I'm doing is I'm filing away. On half of them, I'm filing away the little bead of glue that came out. On half the other half, I'm filing away the step left in the plastic because it didn't fit together very well. Because it's an old kit. This side is mostly step, and that side is mostly glue bead. Toe beans. I like that phrase. I learned that phrase this week, toe beans. If you look at a cat or a dog, the little pads in their feet, little pink pads that cats have, or dogs, they're called toe beans. Not officially. They're affectionately called toe beans. And I'm like, that's the best thing I've ever heard. Toe beans. I like that. The pads, basically. Cats are the best because they're usually pink, whereas dogs often are like brown or black. Toe beans. Yes, as yet I've not heard Mama Fox open the freezer and go in it, so I guess we're going to be having takeout for dinner again. Like I'm on a low-fat, low-salt diet or anything, but I don't know. Can't get the staff. You just can't get the staff. Toe beans. I'm doing this now. You watch. There'll be something that goes alongside this and covers up most of these. Most of these areas, anyway. But it's worth doing. I went to the adequate school of seam removal. If it's worth doing adequately. That's a Rocco's Modern Life reference for anyone out there who would get that. Probably nobody, I suspect. Have a look at chat in a moment. Carried away. I'm not actually saying anything, am I? Toe beans! It's a great phrase. So I'm just basically smoothing this all down now from the rough filing. It'll be fine. Once it's got all painted up, I'll do some heat staining on it. It'll hide a lot of things anyway, so. It's going to be a Space Marine vehicle, so it's not going to be like. I know these are supposed to be old. A lot of the technology is supposed to be old and venerated, but it's. It's not like Imperial Guard stuff. It's going to be a bit better maintained than bog standard Imperial Guard stuff, I think. It's not going to be quite as battered and weathered. as some of the other things I've built. And that's a bit too small, I think. But there'll definitely be like heat staining on the exhausts. So we can get away with a little bit here. Bit of shenaniganery. Shenaniganery. Now you do have here where these two have glued together, you've got the little chink in the inside of the exhaust tube there. It's not quite circular. I can't say I love that particularly, but there's not really a lot I can do about it. So we shall just have to hope it's less obvious when it's weathered. Oops. And that's where you could potentially use sprue goo or filler, but then you have them to file out the tube, and yeah. I'm not going to get into that much detail, I don't think. The thing with this is, like many of the things I have, if it's a kit that I'm doing for selling, then I'll do everything I can to make it as best as possible, because people are going to pay for it. If it's something that I'm not going to be selling, because this was a gift, it's for my own army, I'm not quite as finicky as things for my own army. I'll still try and make them look good, but I'm not going to lose sleep over the fact there's a bit of a mould line here or a seam there or something. I can kind of live with that a bit more on my own build, because theoretically, you're only ever going to get seen from like 3 or 4 feet away on a tabletop. Assuming I ever get to play. Is that cleaned? What's next before we take this tape off? Have a quick look at chat. I haven't made, but I painted them like the box set. Now I want to do a cream colour, says Underdog. When I do mine, I'm thinking of that kind of bone white, off rusty, mingy, horrible colour rather than green. I don't think I'm going to go for the Death God green. I do need to strip them all down like the Space Marines from Conquest because I need to repaint them all. A WASGIDGE is where the pictures on the box is. Hang on. A WASGIDGE is where the picture on the box is reacting to the picture of the puzzle. You get a hint, but that's all. Okay. Okay, I get it. I love where he blew the lid and said it's not layer painting, it's glaze painting, says Mayhem. I don't know what this is about. It's like the Warhammer video when they cut back after a second coat and it's full of tones and shadows. That is one thing to keep in mind when you watch things like, you know, those videos. Not all the time, but a lot of times, there are things you aren't being told. Like, you know, do you, if you, like somebody like Duncan painting a face, or, Peachy painting a face, or not just that channel, but other channels, do you, you know, they might be like, right, you've done your Bugman's Glow and you've done your Reichland Flesh Shade, now do a coat of Kislev, Acadian Flesh Tone, on the, and then do a smaller highlight coat, and it's like, yeah, what you're not showing is how you're fading it and blending it. They don't show that. But then again, if you're doing a 20-minute video, you know, you're kind of limited to what they can show, I suppose, in that time. Right, next is track, so we have to take this stuff off. Hope this works. Yeah, there are things you don't get shown. Like, I've said it before, when I show painting the stripes that need cleaning up now, stripes on the dozer blade, and I explained how you don't get shown all the back and forth cleanup. When anybody shows you, like a lot of the videos, especially Warhammer TV, they show you freehanding and things like that. They don't actually show you the full process because they don't show you all the back and forth cleaning up, especially for checkers, painting checker patterns. It's like, you know, you paint the black bits, then you paint the white bits. Or you paint the white bit, then you paint the black squares. Then you go back onto the white and tidy up all the bits where the squares are a bit funny shaped. Then you go back and tidy up all the white where the black went wrong. And then you go backwards and forwards over and over and over. And they don't show you that. But then again, you've got to consider it's a consideration of time as well as anything else. So I could have left that on actually because... Oh well, it's staying in place. I could have left it on because I've got to do all the track yet. Let's get all the bits. So yes, there's a lot you don't get shown. There's a lot of shortcuts, but they are aiming them at beginners. Keep that in mind. So they're just saying, paint this, then paint that, and paint that. Yeah, they're aiming that at beginners. So beginner will probably get enough after that. Mike and Model Works gets 10 internet points saying, hello, Heifer, welcome to, heck, isn't that, hey, this is a kid's show. Hey, g'day, Hef. You get an extra point for referencing Rocco's Modern Life. Sounds good. I am currently trying to get good with glazing and various blending methods, says Phil East. Practice makes more practice, I guess, says Mayhem. Goodbye Star comes from a webcomic where a dog just says, I don't think the cat likes me. All I ever see is his goodbye star. I have loved the phrase since then, says Lee Stevenson. I don't know what you're talking about there, but I like the phrase. Donald McKenzie. Hi, Donald. I'll start that again. Wow, not talking well. Donald McKenzie says, belly, fish and dirty fried. Fish and dirty fried from the local hotel. Dirty fried. Bench, Revel, easy click, tie interceptor to go with the Darth tie for the lad's Star Wars shelf. Cool. On cats, toe beans conceal the claws of bleeding, says Panzer Koenig. Yeah, absolutely. A cute thing to hide the dangerous things. Wow! Swig of coffee, learn to talk. Oh, there we go, Lee says. And to go with the toe beans, you have the goodbye star. There we go. Now I understand. Always thought that the engine unit of the Land Raider could make an insane quad melter or some such. Yeah. It looks like the bit you get on the back of a dreadnought. I do like that there. I like the engine detail in there as well. It's kind of cool. You can't really see it, but... like, this is very similar to the engine detail you see inside the Stormfang gunship. Considering the Death Guard are supposed to be off-white bone colour anyway, says Mayhem. Oh, okay. Yeah, I like that colour. I must strip down my Mortarion and repaint him in those colours. Orcs will be goths, mostly black, but I'm going to give them some khaki reds, yes, and checkered patterns, of course. Yes, checkers required. I've got to figure out, right, I don't know if I can get it without destroying everything, but on the Dacker Jet, can I get this out without making everything fall over and that? On the Dacker Jet. You have the checker patterns on the... you get decals to put checkers on the tips of the wings. You get like a little decal there. And the decal is black and white checkers. But on the box art, they are black checkers and the colour underneath is black and then the colour of the plane. So if it's a red plane, it's got black and red checkers. If it's a yellow plane, it's got black and yellow checkers on the box art. And I'm like, well, hang on. The decals aren't black and clear. They're black and white. So... that means the person that's done the box art has painted checkers on this wing, on the leading edge of the wings. I'm like, what? I'm not doing that. That's far beyond my... I can do checker pattern. I can't do checker patterns on a slightly tiny compound curve like that. It'd be a nightmare. Because I'm like, it's not black. If it was a black and clear decal, that would be easy. He just shows the colour through. But if it's black and white, I don't know how they've done it. So, yeah, it'll be black and white checkers on my... I think I'm going to paint it red. Dad'll be happy with that. I think it's going to get a red paint. I might do a dark brown pre-shade on it. But yeah, so it's going to have black and white checkers. Because I can't freehand checkers on there. That's insane level of skill needed for that I haven't got. Like I say, I quite enjoy doing checker patterns, but yeah, not on that. Paul Di Tommaso is in. Hey, Paul, my friend. How are you doing? Welcome, welcome. Any orcs I ever acknowledge is good, bad moons and speed freaks as evils, aka evil sons. Orcs are my orcs are neutral tones with a few bits of yellow armor, so probably count as bad moons. You mean goths? People talking about orcs. Hello, everybody. Says Paul. Welcome, Paul. Or they go black on. Or they got black. Oh, it's moved. Or they got black on a clear checker aftermarket decal, says EC Idaho. Not the guys that painted the actual box art. Oh, they might have done, but they wouldn't tell you that. Yeah, they give you specific decals for the trailing, the leading edges, but yeah, it's not reflected in the box art. The box art shows black and whatever the full colour is. Give the decal a coat of ink, Fox. The black will stay black, but the white will change with the ink. That's a thought. Or I could just paint the base. Yeah, but then the checkers are like micros. They really are tiny. We'll see. We'll see how it goes. Might just leak them as black and white. Don't know. I think if it's red, but it's got black and white checkers. It was going to be red or yellow. I'm not decided yet. Wanders back in with coffee and food. Says Muse. Welcome, Muse.
Right. Track time.
Track.
And.
Track. Give them points for putting the track on different sides. We like this. Also, left 5, 4, 3, 2. Yes, they marked them as well. At least, even though they didn't number the parts, they had the good sense to actually number the tracks. I have to give Games Workshop credit for that. Let's get these things on here. But we need to take these parts off now. We want all the track parts. Just get them off. Quickly. And then I feel like there's been an endless series of adding tracks to vehicles lately. It just seems to be that way. I've been on a track to vehicle kick the last few months. Yeah, so I'm feeling a lot more positive now. I've got those little clear sort of storage boxes. They're just a couple of really useful box company storage boxes. Basically, what was happening was every time I finished a build like this before painting it, I had nowhere to put it. My cabinet was full. There's no space in the room where all my kits are, in the spare room, because it's full of everything. And it was quite stressful. It was a bit depressing because I'm thinking, I can't, because normally, you know, I'm building things and then I'm painting them and then I'm selling them. And I'm not getting this problem. But because of the last year, of course, I can't go out and post things. I've not been able to do that, so. It's been quite stressful because I'm building things and then not really having my mojo, painting mojo has been affected because I can't paint them because once they're painted, I've got nowhere to put them and I can't sell them. Oh, it's quite frustrating. So to have that all cleared up now and I've got to get them built and then stored away in the box, at least they can go into a nice box and stay there safely protected. And I've got space in the cabinet, so when I do paint things, I can store them in there. So it means I can crack on with painting and stuff now again. Until I've got somewhere to store them all until I can sell them. So happy times. But it's improved my mood a little bit. It's quite frustrating. Quite stressful. Not being able to sell them. Because it's like a third of my income. Doing nothing. It was affecting the mojo a bit. And also seeing all these things piling up and I'm like, crap, I finished this kit now, this whatever Baneblade or whatever. Where the hell do I put it? I'm trying to figure out where to put something now I've built it. It just takes the fun out of it. Anything that gets in the way of the fun of the hobby just becomes a pain. So now I can get them built and stored in the box. That's fine. Happy now. Of course, as soon as they get painted, they'll go into the display cabinet. Or I might just, well, as Mama Fox orders things off Amazon, of course, there's nothing to stop me getting something painted, built. Painted, photographed, stick it in a little plastic tub, stick it in a box, and then it's just awaiting a label and a buyer then, for when I can eventually sell it. So, yeah, so that might do. But then I've got to find somewhere to put the box. So, yeah, same problem. But I'm feeling much more positive now. Now I've got somewhere to store these things when they've been built. Because I was kind of slowing down with the building because I'm thinking, I'm building all this stuff and there's nowhere to put it. I need to slow down, but I can't slow down because... Yeah. Right, what are these tracks like? Nubby. Red ones go faster, says Raging Modeler. This is indeed true. How's the audio and video, by the way, guys? Hope we're looking and sounding okay. Nub. But yes, my plan is... Get this one done for Goblin. Hopefully that will kick my painting mojo back into gear. And then go back to the Lehman Russ and get that done. Get it done, Marine. Now, there is a mold line on there, but... Can I get away with making that part of the track? I don't know. No, probably not. Probably not. Just get rid of it. bit of a pain, but looks better if I get rid of it. Just a little mold line at the bottom of the track, which you could get away with saying it's part of the track, like two separate pieces of track machinery, but yeah, we'll just get rid of it. Yeah, it has been kind of tough the last few months. Just, I'm not going to go into detail, obviously, but just real life stuff getting in the way, so it's keeping me away from the bench. Yeah, and I get quite disheartened by it, because it's like, yeah, I want to get to the bench and do the work because it's what I enjoy doing, but also I've got a commitment to my, you know, patrons and channel members to do content. But I feel like I'm letting them down. It's just quite frustrating. I want to be at the bench and I can't be. And then that kills your mojo a bit, and then when you can get to the bench, you're like, oh. I'm a sensitive soul, what can I say? By sensitive soul, I mean idiot, obviously. Obviously. Sandulations. Oh, hello, big nubs, big nubs. Hey, right, big nubs. Great big nubs. Get them shandied away. There you go. Lovely. Much better. My belly's making noises. See, if Mama Fox decides she can't be bothered going to the freezer and pulling something out to defrost, which it's now 20 past four. She's not done it, so yeah. And she wants Chinese. Ooh, that's going to be the third day this week I've had to have curry rice and chips and big sausage. Ooh. Not if I can do that again. Something else instead. Right, there we go, that'll do. It's not perfect, but again, as with all tracked vehicles, I will be muddying these up. In fact, am I urinating into the direction of the oncoming gust here? What is that L5? Because I'm thinking that, are these actually completely hidden by the side of the... Yeah, I didn't need to do any of that. They kind of line up with the... That little mould line, it's hidden by... Yeah, we'll just not bother with that. Let's just crack on, shall we? Let's just crack on now. There we go. I suddenly thought, hang on, is any, all the stuff that I'm taking care to sand away going to be hidden? Yes, it's going to be hidden. Mine. Just get them looking nice. And of course, I'm going to be covering them in mud and dirt. So, yeah. And even on a well pristine maintained vehicle, because it's Space Marines, cracks are the one thing that is going to be battered regardless, because it's the bit that's in contact with the road surface. Excuse me. See what chat's doing. Back on track, Fox. Oh, banned. Hi, Muse. Says Colin to Muse. Muse is back. Audio and video both great for me. I have the opposite. I should be building faster than I buy. I was totally dead asleep and missed your show, says Muse to Colin. Aww. Audio and video fine, Gemma. That's okay, Muse. No worries. Perfect Woodley. I'm trying to make good progress, but then birthday and Christmas boosted the stash right back up. Definitely not complaining, though, says Phil. Oh, yeah. Lee says, my wife and I are both buying hobby stuff and using hobby stuff are two different hobbies. Yes. We won't talk about the 5 crates of models just in this room. Friends and family had added into it too, says Muse. Yeah. My pile of shame isn't that bad, but I haven't added the Cesarbi and Frame Arms Girl to the garage stuff in the house yet, says Lee. Ah, yes. Should add those things. Yes, it's quite frustrating. I mean, I've stopped buying stuff because I ran out of space in the spare room for all the kits. Because the thing is, in the spare room, I've got all my little bits of stash, and the stash under this bench as well. And I've stopped buying stuff because A, I can't keep buying things when I've got a stash to make. And B, the front room is also full of boxes full of all the Warhammer Conquest stuff and boxes full of the X-Wing stuff. The Warhammer Conquest stuff just takes up so much space. So, I can't buy anything else now because I need to work through my stash, because there really is nowhere to put anything else. So I've vowed now, basically, I can't buy anything. Apart from, you know, a paint and thing, a brush and things like that, and bits I need. But in terms of kits, I can't buy anything now until I've actually built all my Warhammer stuff. Because I've got, it's not a big stash of Warhammer stuff, but I've got a big enough stash to keep me going for Warhammer Sundays. But eventually I'm going to have built the last thing. At that point, yes, I'm going to have to buy some more kits because I need stuff for Warhammer Sunday. But by getting everything built like this on these Warhammer Sundays, it means they're out of the stash, which makes the spare room less full. It also means I've got content for you guys on a Sunday. And now I can store them all away in a box. In some storage crates quite nicely. So as long as they're not, I mean, the difficulty is when it's like a big pointy thing with lots of spikes and sticky out bits, that's quite tricky to put in the storage box. When it's a box like that, plonk it in the crate, there you go, done. So yeah, we'll see. It's easier for me to have three or four storage crates stacked up in the footprint of one storage crate than it is to have lots of boxes and models and built mod. Because the thing is with the built mod, you can't just leave it sitting around. My problem was I had nowhere to put the Baneblade. Like, the Baneblade's a big old girl. I'm like, well, if I put it in my cabinet, I've got to move like six other things out of the cabinet, but where do I put them? In the end, I'm like, I'll get some really useful box company crates. This show is not supported or sponsored by the Really Useful Box Company. I do think, though, I have some of their boxes in my Amazon store. A bit of a segue. As Amazon store, which is linked in the description below this video, probably in the essential tools and items section, but might not be. Have a look around. If not, I must add them later on. So let me know if I've not put them in there. Let me know. Right. So let's consider the tracks of happiness. We have L1 off camera. Yes, L1. El Dopa. Nope. L2. L1. L2. L3. El Cid. El Ted. Where's L? Where's L3? L3, which is... Keeping in mind, I've got to make sure the little pointy down bits are actually pointing down. Then I'm going to guess 4. Yes. It's kind of handy the way they make the tread out like little arrows. It's kind of handy. 4, 5, which is there. Which will be that one. With a little... That's weird. Oh no. Right, well, L5 is on that side. That way, and then 6 be that way, and 7, 8, 9. Okay, I'm running out of space here. I like to get them laid out in order and in the right orientation, just so I know I can't possibly screw it up. I mean, I can possibly screw it up, but you know, hey, that was 6, 7. Now you can't see what way around these are now, so you just have to go off the tread pattern. 8, 9, except that's 7 there, 6, 7, now, like the Baneblade, these don't actually have to line up on the top because it's covered up, so that's a good thing. We start with L1.
L1.
Which is a little notch there. And we've had this way around, so it should theoretically be the wrong way around. Yeah, pretty much. It starts there. Notch there, and that notch goes into that little tab there. So that should locks that in place. So unlike the Baneblade, where it's a bit free roaming, these are actually only got one way to go. Now, there is a bit of play in that, so we'll have to go carefully. It goes round here, but as long as it... Right, let's do it the easiest way. this bit goes in here like that. Five. That locks into there. I'm doing that off camera, I do apologize. Five, six. There's some play in that as well. So we'll go around and see how we get on. So L1, first of all. Get on. Get on. Yeah. One. Two. Sits like that. Three. Lines up there like that. That locks those in place. So we can do that. That's fine. If I push that, take those two off. Keep that there. Get my extra thin for going into the little gaps. Run it into the little gaps. I know I'm not gluing it on the little tabs and sockets, but that's fine. The extra thin will run into the little crevices and creases and do its magical wondrousness. Get under that. There we go, done. So then the next one will be two, which goes like that. Oops, which you drop on there like that, you see? Like that, you see? That sits there like that. You just plonk some CA glue, some extra thin glue down there. Perfect. Apologies if this is off camera. I do like the way GW do their tracks. It is quite pleasing in a very simple kind of way. Put some glue on there this time, just for the sake of speed. You know, I look at people making their tracks, their tanks with their individual track links. I'm like, oh no. Count me out of that one. To quote Master Chief, that's not going to happen. Should sit in there like that because we're missing L4. El dopa, L4. El dead. Got ahead of myself there, didn't I? Got a little bit ahead of myself. Yes, I did. That. You should push down there like that. You'll see, there we go. Yeah, so that mould line is actually hidden by the structure of the tank anyway. It disappears into the gap, so I didn't need to worry about that, did I? No, not at all. No. Yep. That should be more than enough to hold all that goodness in place. And again, don't forget, it will be covered in dirt and dust and mud. So if there are any sins to be covered up, dirt and dust will do that most adequately. That's on there. Lovely. Yeah, I do like the way they do tracks. I know it's not, you know, your purist would be like a child's toy. It's like, well, yeah, it's meant for tabletop gameplay. But you know, it does work quite nicely. Now, and obviously, if you're building a World War II tank, this wouldn't really work because it would look a bit silly. And also, you wouldn't be able to have saggy tracks like you do the real tanks. But because you can't actually see all the wheels anyway, it works perfectly for these kind of things. I like it. It just makes life nice and simple. For someone who's not a big tank freak, I'm not a big fan of tanks. I don't mind them, but I'm not a big tank nut. Then we want this one. Like that. There we go. I think I can cut a little corner here. These are single individual ones. Let's cut a little corner. Get a bit of the old Tamiya extra fat. It's another way. If you only got the fat cement, you can do it this way as well. Just plonk them down like that. That one there, that one there. And then... that's them in, and I can run a little bit of extra thin just down. Two reasons I want to do the extra thin in there. One is it just increases the bond. Like I say, the extra thin melts the plastic and welds it together. And that's what the other cement does as well, but just not quite as intensely. But also, there is a little bit of roughness on the side of those tracks where I've sanded it, scraped it. The extra thin will just soften those edges a little bit. Little bit of wiggle room because of the extra because of the fat cement. You can just adjust those. Two way look lovely. There you go. One side done. Done and done. Let's get the next lot of tracks sorted out. Yeah, you can tell the plastic isn't anywhere near as nice as a modern 40k kit. Because it's just got a little bit of grain to it, which is weird. Make sure they're straight. There you go, nice. I like them tracks, they're quite cool. Next one. Next set of tracks, please. Track here number four, please. Quick look at chat. I've just done some research and apparently some fish are triggered by the colour red. Yes, some fish, especially the ones that have red bellies at mating time. There's a famous experiment carried out by some bloke in Holland. In Amsterdam, it wasn't an experiment, but a thing he observed. I can't remember who it was, so don't ask me. I remember watching it. Basically, it was some guy who had some fish in a tank in Amsterdam in the late 1800s. He was a biologist, and he noticed that every time, at the same time every day, his fish would start going crazy in the tank. The tank was in the window, and it looked out onto the street. And his tank would always go crazy at the same time every day, changing their behaviour into kind of aggressive fighting behaviour. And he was like, why is it the same time? Why? How do they know? First of all, how do they know what time it is and what's causing it? And they were like little silver fish with red bellies, bellies that go red when it's mating time. And he found out what was happening was that at the same time every day, the local postal van went past. It may have been a horse and carriage. I remember it's 18 something or other. The local postal van or vehicle went past and it was red. I think it might have been early 20th century. And every time it went past the window and stopped, the fish would go bananas. And basically what was happening was they were programmed to see red as a colour of aggression and competition. Because when it comes to mating time, they all develop these red bellies. And I think it was either somebody did a super chat there. Whoa, Wayne Ward, $50. Loves and hugs. Wayne, thank you very much. That's insanely kind of you. Thank you massively. You're a very good man. Thank you massively. That's very, very kind. That's sorted my lot of bills out for the next month, to be perfectly honest. Thank you very much for that. That's awesome. Awesome. You're very, very kind. I can't thank you enough. Thank you, thank you, thank you. So it was either that it makes the males develop a red belly to make them more attractive to the females, but then it also triggers them to fight each other for dominance, or it was the females developed a red belly to signify they were ready to breed, ready to mate, and therefore the males go berserk and start fighting each other for competition. It was one of the two, and they were being triggered by the red post van. So maybe you've got one of them, and given all the stuff around you is red, I won't be surprised. See, you always learn a little bit of science on Fox's live streams. Always learn a little bit of science stuff. Not necessarily correct. I love science. Science is the best thing in the world. If you don't love science, you're doing it wrong. I love talking about science. I don't know that much about science. I like to think I do, but I don't really. I do find it fascinating. Yeah, thank you very much for that, Wayne. That's very, very kind of you, my friend. You're a very, very nice man. It's not true what they say about you. You're lovely. You are lovely. It's not true what they say about you. Thank you, dude. Yeah, you've paid a few bills there, mate. That's very kind of you. I just renewed my domain, actually, as well. Quite nice. Another couple of years. Just paid for that. Lovely. Actually, I'm pretty bad. You know, I've all got my model making .guru website. I'm terrible at updating it. I always forget. I really must do more on that website, but it's such a chat, such a faff doing stuff on the website. Right, so there we go. Have a quick look at chat. Where are we up to? That Dan Piranha video introduced me to 40k, and I've been on it ever since, says Phil East. It was my first ever 40k as well, like Piranha. And yeah, I fell in love with it straight away. I haven't bought within a few months, but that kind of other stuff, that's better, bigger screen, says Muse, good girl. 37 watching and only 20 likes, come on people, says Muse. Yeah, everybody give it a thumbs up. I've got mainly Warhammer stuff for the past couple of years. I'm hooked on improving my brush painting, or well, trying to. I, of course, when I first started out, you'll know, a lot of you who are here from, you know, from the beginning, I started off doing Gunpla. And that was my big thing, because I'd done all kinds of models over the years, and I got a bit burnt out, and then I found Gunpla, and my mind was blown. And I got into Gunpla. I'm like, wait, you mean I don't enjoy the building part of the process, but yeah, here's a kit where the building part is made so easy that I'm going to enjoy it, because it's push fit. And that was my gig for a couple of years, good 2 or 3 years. And then I discovered Warhammer. And I just fell in love with that. And that kind of pushed Gunpla to one side for a bit. And I don't make any bones about it, you know. I've said before, the worst thing I can do is try and force myself to stick to a specific kind of content that I think people want to see. Because that just means I'm making stuff I don't want to make. Or I can end up making stuff I don't want to make. And that means my content suffers. I've always held the, you know, I've always been open about it and said, I will go wherever the passion takes me. If I suddenly find that I want to make, I don't know, if my passion suddenly changes and all I want to do now is make World War II tramp steamers for the next 2 years, I'll do that. And it might be stuff that people doesn't want to see, but I'm not going to do things I don't want to do just for the views. I'm not that disingenuous. I do what I do to teach people how to do what I do and to show them that it's not that hard. But I also need to do what I do for the enjoyment of it. And I'm not going to do that. I'm doing it for a living, but I'm not going to do it just for the money. You know what I mean? That's why I haven't got thumbnails with my face in the thumbnail, because that's just a cheesy YouTube marketing trick that you see all the time. From crap channels, you know, like reaction video type. I don't mean like model. I mean like people that do reaction videos and YouTube celeb nonsense and internet gossip and stuff. Excuse me. I hate that. I see those kind of videos and I just instantly don't bother watching them. Not that I do anyway. I hate all this idea. I hate the idea of like YouTube celebrities and all this kind of. It's like they're just irrelevant crap channels. Why would somebody want to watch a YouTube channel where all the YouTube channel talks about is other YouTubers and like gossip? Why do people watch that crap? It's just like mindless drivel. I don't understand. Just absolute nonsense. Anyway, yeah, so I won't say I'm not motivated by the money because I'm doing this for a living, but I'm not motivated 100% by the money. I'm not doing it just purely for the money. I'm doing it because I enjoy doing it. I enjoy teaching people. And, you know, like I say, I'm going to work on what I enjoy working on and hopefully at the same time teach people. Because at the end of the day, all the techniques I use on Warhammer, you can use on Gunpla or World War II tanks or 18th century steamships or whatever you want to work on. I've always said it doesn't really matter what I'm physically working on. It doesn't matter what the subject of my videos is, really. What's important is the things that I do in those videos, the techniques that I use. Everything else is not that important. So, yeah. I've always been honest about that. Right, R1. I'm a secret limb. That's the wrong thing. That's R whites. R1 is that way with the eagle pointing thusly. Now, see, this is where they've actually got their instructions wrong, and they did this on the rhinos as well. I don't know if you'll see, but on R1, you've got the eagle at the top of the tracks here. There's R1. arrow pointing down, which was the original name of the giant bomb cast before it was a giant bomb cast. R1, eagle at the top. That one, eagle at the top. This is R1. And the eagle's not at the top, the eagle's down there. So, that instantly, there's no way to make that match. Absolutely impossible. It's the right piece of track, but it's not. They want you to make it so that the eagle's there and it looks nice and neat and tidy. It's not. It just doesn't. It's not the same. It's like if you do the Plague Burst Crawler, the Death Guard Plague Burst Crawler, the tracks on that are completely wrong. I don't know if it's the instructions are wrong or the tracks are made wrong, but I think if I remember rightly, on one side it shows you putting the tracks a certain way around, on the other side it shows another way around, and you can't build them like that. Like, it'd be like the tracks are supposed to go like this, but the only way it fits is like that. That's what the Plague Burst Crawler's like. So, yeah, it's not a very good job there, I'm afraid. Right, so R1. Two. Three. There's three. Eins, zwei, drei. Yeah. Umf. Sechs. Sieben. Acht, neun. Yeah, so you have to watch the instructions sometimes. They can go a bit funky with that instructionating. We have five and six. Yeah, that's right. So let us apply these. I'm going to just use the thick cement for this one. I'm going to try to see if it's faster in the spirit of experimentations and sciencings. I'm going to see if it's faster just to use the thick cement and then go back with the thin cement afterwards. Just run some thick cement on there. Sponge that down. I've put the tracks in the wrong place now, haven't I, really? To where the camera is, put that on there, and we'll run a bit of glue around there, the inside. Track number two, cache number two, please. Track number three, because this glue is pretty good, it'll sit there for like 2 or 3 minutes before it becomes not particularly gloopy anymore and sticky. You can work with it. And then we have a little one here. And the little one said, move over. I've not heard that song since I was like six. I don't even remember what it was. It just come into my head now. So, yes, I mean, I'll always go where the interest takes me. And I'll always be true to that because at the end of the day, that's not got any glue on there. I'll always be true to that because at the end of the day, it's better for me to make content that I enjoy actually doing, because that will show through in the video, that will come through in the content. If I'm making something that I don't want to make, you will know it. You'll be able to tell. It's not, I can't hide it that well. You'll easily know that I'm there. I'm not really wanting to make it. And I'll be honest with you and say there are things on my channel where I was making something that I didn't particularly want to make, and it's kind of, to me, it's kind of obvious. Because you can tell I'm doing things a little differently than I normally would. I'm rushing through steps. I'm giving less detailed information. I'm cutting corners. I'm not enjoying the process. I'm also not on camera. Hooray! I don't like doing that. I want to be honest. I want to be transparent. And I want to give you... I can't teach you if I'm not really in the mood to teach. If I'm half-arsing it, you're not going to learn anything if I'm not teaching you properly. Ugh, fudge tack. Come out. There you go. So, if I suddenly decided today that I don't want to do Warhammer anymore and I really want to do, I don't know, like 18th century steamships, that's what I'll do. And does it mean that I might lose some viewers? Yeah. I'd live, I'd survive. There'd always be people to watch the stuff. I don't think that's going to happen, by the way. Don't start panicking out there in Tellyland. It's not about to happen. Warhammer, it's that good. I might start to branch out into other things. I know people really want me to go back to Gunpla, and I will do it at some point. But I mean, you know, I got a bit burnt out on it. I've done it enough, and I kind of Warhammer came along and made me even more interested in that. And I will go back to Gunpla because I've got my Kshatriya to do at some point this year. In the schedule there, I've got a plan for that now. I kind of know roughly what I'm going to do with it. So I've not gone off Gunpla. It's just I got burnt out on it, and especially with Gunpla, for example, where towards the end of it, I kind of figured out a way to paint it well. But I think the thing with Gunpla is I was trying to build it in such a way that it was still poseable, and all your joints were still, you know, movable, and that burnt me out because that was too much thinking and stress. I want to build a model and then paint it. I don't want to have to build it and then try and think ahead of myself and plan how I'm going to paint it. And how can I do this? And if I do this bit now, then I can't paint it because when I do that bit, all the paint will come off. If I move it, yeah, that was too much like thinking. So I got burnt out. But then towards the end of it, when I did George's Cesarbi, I realised I can just glue a gumpet in a pose and paint it like a normal model. That turned me around. So, of course, I will go back to Gunpla because I know that now. There we go, that's tracks done. Done quite a lot so far, haven't I? Got things and stuff and yeah. Excellent. We'll put that over there, it's quite big, quite hefty. Yeah, we'll put that over there in the clunking of the microphone. Have a quick look at the chat. Where are we? Lee Stevens said to Phil East, I haven't got to the point where I'm happy enough with my brush painting that I feel happy with the results, so I'm not quite restful. The thing to keep in mind, and this is like me, the way I do things, I need to wipe my nose because of course I've got the sniffles. I've come to terms with the way I paint stuff. What I mean by that is, a lot of people see, for example, the box art, or the way they paint on Warhammer TV, or the way like proper top-notch professional painters like Sam Lenz or, you know, even Cy Reynolds in the Boom Hut paint the glazes and layers and stuff. And they see all that and they think, I want to be able to paint like that, but I can't paint like that, and I get sad. I don't do that. I've come to terms with the fact that my painting style is beginner-friendly, let's say. Just trying to wipe my nose while I'm talking, sorry. I see myself more as a kind of impressionist. In a world where everybody wants to be a photorealistic painter. As in, you know, let's look at the work of two-dimensional art. You've got impressionists, and then you've got the photorealists. Photorealists make these paintings, they're big, massive, like 10 foot by 5 foot, that look like photographs, but they're paintings. And then you've got your impressionists who use broad brushstrokes to just suggest a thing. I'm quite happy and comfortable with the fact that my painting style is kind of impressionistic. It's simple colours. It's not using lots of glazes and transitions. It's simple colour washes and shades just to make things look good. I would never enter a competition because I'm nowhere near good enough. I wouldn't even stand a chance. And I don't purport to be that. But as I'm teaching people all the time, I'm quite happy with my painting skill level being at that level. Because I'm teaching people how to get going, how to get started, and how to move on from there. And I'm happy with that. Could I get better? Absolutely, I could. I could spend the time, but I'm quite happy. I might do it at some point, but for the purposes of, you know, what I'm doing, which is filming people, teaching people how to make what I make, I'm going to stick to that. So I'm comfortable with that now. I'm fairly confident that if I put my mind to it, I could learn more betterness. I could do proper glazing and all that kind of stuff if I put my mind to it, if I really made the effort. But I don't feel the need to. I'm comfortable with where I am. So, and it's the same thing you'll learn when doing any kind of artwork. Is where the hell are all the... I really reached a number of these pieces. It is... You should always look to others for inspiration. You should always look to others for advice and ideas and as yardsticks to look at things you can move towards. but you should never look to others as a standard bearer as to where you should be. Like, look at other people's work and say, I wish I could paint like that. And then study that work and study how they've painted like that. And then apply it. But don't be disheartened because you're not as good as that person. I've said it many times before. You know, if you look at someone like a top-notch painter, proper golden demon thing, and you try and paint something and you're like, oh, it's nowhere near as good. I'm just going to give up the will to live now because everything's rubbish. I can't paint like that. And my response to you is, absolutely bloody you can't paint like that because you've been doing it for 5 minutes and he's been doing it for 32 years. Or whoever it is you're looking at, you know, they've been doing it for decades and you've been trying it for 5 minutes. Of course you can't paint like that. Doesn't mean you're not going to be able to paint like that in the future. It doesn't mean you'll never paint like that. But it means you've been doing this for 52 seconds and you're expecting to paint a Rembrandt after getting your first paint kit, paintbrush. No, it doesn't work that way. But what I see, what makes me sad is when that happens, is people, I've seen so many people, they look to somebody who has been at their game for years and years and years, at the top of their game, and they try and emulate that, and when they fail, because they haven't been doing it for years and years and years, they get disheartened. They think, oh, well, I'll never be that good then, I'll just give up. And they, oh, I could never paint like that, you know. And it's like, no, just... It's almost a case of whenever you start anything creative, be it painting or whatever, you absolutely must start out with the mindset, I'm going to be shit. Whatever I do right now is going to be crap. You have to make that mindset in your head. You have to accept that. I mean, there's the rare occasion where somebody picks up a brush and they make a masterpiece the first time. It's like, it's not impossible, but... If you accept, the moment you pick up your first paintbrush, if you accept whatever comes out the other side is going to be absolute ass because you've got no experience and no learnings, then when it does come out absolute ass, you'll be like, yep, that was what I thought it was going to be. Well, let's see if I can make it in there better the next time. You use that because the next time you'll have learned from your creation of ass and you'll have something better and you'll get better and better over time. But that's the problem I see with many people. They go into whatever the creative endeavor is, not just painting models. They go into an endeavor thinking, just because I know what I need to do, I can do it. Just because I've watched a YouTube video of somebody doing this and telling me all the facts I need to know, I'm going to be able to do it. No, it doesn't work that way. It does not work that way. Just because you've watched a video about glazes and you understand the concept and you understand what a glaze is and how to use it, doesn't mean you can actually do it. For example, because there's muscle memory, there's experience, there's learning how things vary from what you've just watched on YouTube. Because YouTube is a condensed, you know, you watch a YouTube tutorial, even mine, they're condensed. I can't take you through every single potential possibility of something. I have to keep things simple, otherwise it'd be a 72-hour video. You know, if I'm saying, how do I do this? Well, here's what you need and here's what you do. I'm going to tell you what you need and how you do it. I can't go through, here's what you need, here's what you do, and if this happens, do this, and if this happens, do that. I can't take you through that. It's not practical for creators to do that. So there's a certain amount of you're on your own. And that's where you must have this idea. Because you've got to learn, you know, like airbrushing. There's not a lot of knowledge. There's not a lot to actually learn. But the actual physical act of airbrushing, there's a lot of nuance to it. You've got to learn how to feel what the paint's doing through your fingers. You've got to learn how to see what the paint's doing with your eyes and understand what that means. And, you know, you've got to learn to look at the paint and say, I need to back off, or I need to put more pressure on, I need to go in heavier. These are all things you'll learn. You don't learn these straight away by watching a YouTube video. That's not how it works. You need to get the experience. And if you go into a new venture, creative adventure, and you accept the fact that the first thing you do is going to be, more often than not, most likely is going to be absolute balls, then you'll be perfectly happy when that actually happens. Because in your mind, you've already accepted the fact that A, it was going to be bish, and B, over time, you will learn the muscle memory, you will learn the skills, and you'll get better. And that's the thing. That's the difference. That's the one piece of advice I can give to people. It's expect to be crap. Expect to get better. That's it. Don't ever assume that you know everything. But don't compare yourself. But if you accept the fact that you're going to be rubbish at the start, it's very important that you still have your icons that you look at, your people who do what you want to do, and they do it really well. You know, your Sam Lenses and your Cy Reynolds and people like that. Hold them up as a standard that you wish to achieve. And accept two things. Accept one simple possible... Well, it's two things you want to accept right from the start. One, when you start out, you'll be garbage. That is always the case. There's no way around that. Impossible to be otherwise. Accept that you'll be garbage the first time. And accept that when it comes to how good you will get over time, there's only two possibilities compared to your icons, your idols. One, you'll be worse than them. Or two, you'll be better than them. It's the only possibility. Well, yeah, you could say the third is you'll be as good as them, but it's just getting more unnecessarily complex. If you accept all that, then you're fine. Because if you set yourself the goal to get better than them, and that's it, and I'm going to be better than them, then you're knackered. Because if you don't get better than them, you'll get disheartened and you'll give up. So accept that you'll either be as good as or better than or whatever, and just do what you want to do. Just crack on with it. Eventually, you might get to the point where you realise, I'm never going to be as good as that person. I've been doing this for 10 years now and I've still not quite got as good as them. But by that point, you'll have been through so much that you realise, and that's fine. Like me, like I said, I'm no Cy Reynolds, I'm no Sam Lenz, I'm no... I can't think of any other names to put in there right now, but I accept that. My style is a specific style, and it's more impressionistic than realistic, in the same way that Games Workshop box art style is a specific style, and it's not, you know, there's different ways to interpret things. I'm happy that the way I am right now, the way I paint, is more advanced than most beginners, but not so advanced that they can't get there with a bit of hard work and a bit of effort. And then, you know, my idea is that copy what I do, listen to what I say. It's one way of doing it, not the best way. It's a way of doing it. I'm sure there are different ways of all the things I do. But, you know, emulate what I do, copy what I do. It's a stepping stone. Then eventually, once you're quite happy and you can do what I do, that gets to the point then when you're no longer listening to what I'm saying you should do. I need more sanding sticks. You get to the point where first you'll be listening to what I'm saying and doing what I'm doing and trying to copy that to learn. I need, hang on, let me get a sponge. Hang on. No. Yes, at first you'll be depending on what I'm telling you to guide you to what to do. But ever so slowly, you'll start to think for yourself, because some things will become natural and muscle memory, and you'll start finding your own way of doing things, and from that you'll blossom. It's like learning how to fly. I'll need to show you how to fly, but at some point you're going to have to jump out the tree and hope that you don't just explode when you hit the ground. It's like that. It's learning how to fly. And I'm happy that I can take you so far, not further. I don't profess to be a hardcore professional or, you know, that kind of skill level. I would class myself as professional only for the simple fact that I sell my work. I make money from my work. I sell models that have been built and I earn an income. On that simple level, I call myself professional. I do it for a living. I do it as my profession. But in terms of quality and skill level, I don't class myself as professional. You often see the conversation online. What do you class as, like when people sell things on eBay and says pro painted? And there's always a debate about what constitutes pro painted. And one opinion that I have is professional means you do it for a profession. You do it as your profession. That's what professional is. Doesn't necessarily mean you're good. It just means you do it for your living. In that sense, I'm professional. I wouldn't say I was professional in terms of quality. But yeah, so basic rule of thumb is have people to whom you look up. Very convoluted way of saying it. Have people who that you use as waypoints. Artists that you look at and think, I want to paint as well as that person. Absolutely do that. But don't expect to do that right out the gate. Don't get disheartened when you don't do that right out of the gate. And do expect that eventually you'll fly the nest. You'll fly the coop, leave the nest, jump out of the tree, whatever you want to call it. You'll get there. You'll get there. But don't be disheartened in the early days when the stuff you do is not that great. Expect your first works to be absolute bupkis in terms of quality. Some people learn fast, and don't be worried that you've been painting for 2 years and you're still not very good, if you're not very good. Two important things. One, some people, it takes a very long time to get anywhere near good. Some people get it really quickly. That's just, there's nothing wrong with that. And the other thing is, don't forget, of course, you might think that your work is terrible. It might be great. You know, I've done things, I will happily tell you, you know, I've painted stuff and thought to myself, dear Lord, that's just the devil's own arse. It's just terrible. It's painted like with half a potato. I'm really embarrassed by it. And then somebody say, wow, that looks brilliant. That's the best thing I've ever seen. I'm like, really? Sign of a true artist, I've said this before, is that you will always, a true artist hates their own work and thinks their own work is worthless. If somebody thinks their work is perfect and flawless, they're clearly an arse and not worth your time. No artist worth his or her salt will ever say that their work is perfect. They'll always hate it. That's the nature of being an artist. Humbleness, that your own work is nowhere near as good as somebody else's. It's a universal thing. If an artist thinks that, then you know they're a true artist. Well, there's two possibilities. They may actually be that bad and just not got there yet, in which case they're realistic. But if they are very good and they say they're not very good, then that's a proper artist. If they are very good and they say they're very good, then they're clearly an arse. Are not worth your time. So don't get discouraged in the early days. That's what I'm trying to say. It's a long way of saying, do what you do. Do it for yourself. Be happy with what you're doing. And don't panic just because whatever you do. I don't even know how I got onto this conversation. Don't panic just because whatever you're doing in your mind isn't as good as some person's work who's been doing it for 30 years and is a proper hardcore professional and has access to all the tools and things in the world. If you're wondering what I'm doing here, I'm holding up to the light. Yeah, I know you're seeing it out of focus, but it's me holding up to the light to make sure there's no little lines and streaks left. Good. I think that'll do. That'll do, donkey. That'll do. Guns can be a pain to get nubs and things off. I will have a look at chat in a second. Let me just get these guns cleaned. Clean your guns. Now, do I want to drill this barrel out that's like got the diameter of a molecule? I don't know. Because there's all these barrels around here. It's a Gatling gun, basically. If I try and drill that barrel out and it goes wrong, I've ruined the whole damn thing. Yeah, we'll try, maybe. Maybe I'll be a big brave boy and try. What can possibly go wrong? All the things can go wrong. Yeah. So, don't be discouraged. Whenever you start something, accept that you'll be rubbish at first. We all are. We all started the same way. It's always the same. It's never different. Nobody paints their first model or draws their first drawing or writes their first piece of music and creates a masterpiece. Not without experience. Not without making mistakes and learning from them. It's all about learning from mistakes. It's all about accepting that you'll screw things up and not letting it be the end of the thing. You know, if I'm working on something and I'm building it and I'm painting it and it starts to go wrong and I don't know how to recover it, I sit there and I think to myself, well, that's just gone turned to shit really quick. Oh, well. Now, there are times when I abandon a build or a paint job because it's just gone horribly wrong. And I realise there's no rescuing it. But I don't see it as I mean, I sit there and I go, oh, well, that's a real shame because I spent money on that kit and I don't like when I fail. But at the same time, I understand that sometimes that's going to happen. Sometimes you'll work on something and it'll go wrong and there'll be no way to recover it, at least at that point in time. There's always a chance that further down the line you might learn something that will help you recover it. You might do. You might not. It might be completely recoverable. It's even a real word. But you know what? You're making a model and the paint job's gone wrong or the build's gone wrong or it's turned to crap and it's just, you've got no way of recovering it. You know what happens? You go to bed. And the next day, the sun comes up. And the world turns and everyone just carries on. You get a different kit and you start something else and you have fun with that. There'll always be things that go wrong. But it doesn't mean you need to give up the whole hobby. Like Steve, B3, you know, he'll sit there and he'll tell you, I'm not very good at painting, but I like the building part, so I just build them and prime them. Because Steve likes to just leave his models primed. And he's reached that point where he's like, you know what, I'm enjoying doing what I'm doing. Now Steve will tell you, I'm sure, that in his heart of hearts he wants to paint them, and I'm sure he'll be blushing when I say he's more than capable of doing that. But it's a question of, you know, believing in yourself and all that kind of arty-farty Disney nonsense. But it doesn't really matter. I think Steve knows down deep down that if he, you know, he could quite easily paint those, quite happily paint those, and learn the things needed and put his mind to it, he'd be fine. But he doesn't want to, maybe he doesn't want to, and that's fine. There's no problem with that at all. He's happy doing what he's doing, and he's one of the best scratch builders I know. You all know his stuff from the Boom Hut. Which reminds me, by the way, let me check my buttons are working.
Slap it on.
Yep, here's the link to the Boom Hut in the chat. Excuse me, if you want it. If you're not in the Model Makers Boom Hut already, do go and join. It's absolutely free. The safest group on for model makers. You know, he posts his stuff from the Boom Hut. I think he's one of the best scratch builders I know. And he's completely happy. I mean, I'm putting into words into your mouth here, Steve. I know I am, so apologies if you're sitting there going, you're talking rubbish, you are. What are you talking about, Willis? But, you know, there's no physical reason why, you know, Steve couldn't paint stuff, learn how to do it and get the skills in and develop the abilities. But he's happy doing what he's doing. He likes making stuff. He likes the scratch building. That's the bit of the process that's fun for him. And not so much the painting. Same with me. Well, the reverse of me. I like the painting part, not that keen on the building part. If I could just get someone else to build all my crap and I just paint it, that'd be great. Kind of how it works. So, you know, set yourself realistic targets. Don't give up because you're not as good as X, Y, or Z. But also don't assume that you have to get as good as X, Y, or Z. We'll get to that point. And there's, you know, if a build starts to go wrong, don't worry about it. Stop, put it to one side, put it back in the box. Leave it for another day. Because, you know, you come back in a year's time, you may have learned all these skills that you didn't know about then, that you now know, and you'd be able to recover it. Or you might not, and it'll just become a test pig. But even if it's irrecoverable, even if you can't fix it and it's never going to be fixable, at least you've learned something about the process. You've learned some things, or character building nonsense like that. Right. Let's have a quick look at chat. Sorry, got the tickly cough going on again. Quick look at the chat and then we'll be a big brave boy and try drilling out those barrels and hope we don't screw up too much. I came for the gunplot and stayed for the fox, says Lee. Thank you very much. I watched the St. Andrew Stein video and kind of stayed around since then. I'm thinking of them like small Gunpla, which is probably the issue. Wasn't that happy with the individual pieces of my Tau Commander, but like the whole once assembled. There is a popular opinion that the entire reason for the Tau being designed the way they are was kind of Games Workshop's way to attract the Japanese market a bit. You know, people that love giant Japanese mecha. And if that is the case, yeah, I can see that. I hate the channels where it's like, I had a new thing, watch me destroy the thing. Like, money, like, yeah. People that do that, those kind of reaction videos, let me destroy this thing. I just hate any kind of YouTube celebrity, basically. They're all just vapid nonsense. Started when they were new, then life got in the way. I've painted Warhammer 40k for 34 years now, says John Kenwood. Cool. Revell Razor Crest is up for pre-order on eModels, says Lost High Bobbins, Lord High Bobbins. Yay! Go to eModels.co.uk, your one-stop shop for all your model making needs. Link in the description below the video. Go and order your Razor Crest. I've had people ask me to paint things for them. I don't think I'm that good, and I have no desire to be a commissioned painter. The moment I turn it into work, it's ruined for me. Absolutely. Absolutely. I mean, has it changed? If I was to sit here and say, doing this for a living has changed how I see it. It hasn't changed anything at all. I still love the hobby to bits. I'd be lying. It has changed it. It does go from something you do for fun to something you do because you need to. But I'm lucky in that I can still tolerate it. I still enjoy it. But it's not the same. It is true. It does change it. Gina, Chinese or a burger? What a choice to make. How about a Chinese burger? The answer to that is yes, Nim, says Muse. Timothy Kalako's in. Hello, everyone. Good morning, says Timothy. Welcome, Timothy. Nim says, I'm rolling a D20. Odds it's Chinese, Evans. Evens it's a burger. Model making mayhem is... Words. Readying the chicken for the dinner noms. Do it, Foxy, says Muse, but I don't know what we're talking about. So I rolled. I rolled odd, but I rolled a natural one. Ooh. Yeah. Gotta go. Sunday dinner and football with the family. Thanks, Fox. Later, everybody have a good one. Says Phyllis. Take care, my friend. Enjoy your dinner and football. Mighty meaty pizza, says Sarah Jane. Yes, go and do it. The sun will come up tomorrow. Don't you start singing Annie on my live streams. It's not that I like leaving them primed. I'm just not a painter, says B3. Okay, so you'd like to paint them. You don't think you can. I think you can. You just haven't. You haven't developed the comfort of doing it, I think. I think you enjoy building the stuff in primary. I know you want to paint them, but you're playing to your strengths. I don't think it's that you can't paint them. I think it's just haven't got to the point where you're comfortable doing it yet. You'll get there. You need to get more than brown and white paints in your collection as well. Will also help. Nim, need to roll on the consequence table. Odds is spicy, fiery death, even if it's sweet and sticky. Okay. I use my tax return to come in, says Timothy. Oh, I did my tax return the other day. Yay. I bit the bullet the day and put my tax return through. Oh, I see. He says, I need my tax return to come in so I can order my any cubic photon, says Timothy. Cool. Sesame chicken and beef lo mein and I can eat the leftovers tomorrow, says Nim. Good girl. I feel the same way as Fox, says Timothy. I love painting, but if someone could assemble my stuff for me, I'd be happy. Oh, hello, Burpage. We should pair people up so that people who love painting can be given built models by people who love building. Yeah. Realistic targets, that's an issue I need to work on. You have leftovers, that's not how you eat Chinese, says Panzer. Yeah, but then she says she orders extra. I love me the mecha, grew up with Robotech and never lost the love, says Lee. I grew up with Transformers, GoBots, Robotech, Macross and more obscure mecha like Orbots, says Mayhem. All this talk of the Chinese, grr, stomach is rumbling like a loon. Evil laugh, says Nim. I grew up in South Africa, so not much choice, says Lee. Right. Let's build this Storm Bolter, whatever it is. It doesn't even tell you in the... It's like, I'm not saying this is old, but I don't even understand the points in the back. Is this the new 9th edition stuff? I don't even understand what this means. Land Raider Crusader, 9 to 16 plus lots of water drops. Don't know what that means. Something is 10, something is 6, something is 3, something is 8. Wow, they really have changed this, haven't they? I don't know what any of that means. Like, why are there 3 different listings? I don't understand. What doesn't tell you what the weapons are. Yeah, let's just not think about that. So, we need to put the gun on the top. Oh, I missed a piece out. Don't panic. This piece that looks exactly like the one on the Storm Fang. Got to tell you, by the way, that Storm Fang gunship, really nice kit.
That is a fun build.
You want a fun build? Storm Fang's really nice. Like this, but as a flying machine. The Space Wolves. It's a shame it's any Space Wolves, really. But then again, it is shaped like a big wolf head. So it kind of wouldn't really make sense for anybody else. Nice kit, though. It's very fun to build. You want an enjoyable build and paint. That Storm Fang. What is it, 40 quid? It's really nice. Canopy's really nice to mask off and paint. Lovely. I may do another. I don't know. Maybe at some point. We'll see. If I do a Space Wolves, if I do end up doing Space Wolves for my own Space Marines, then I'll have to get another one anyway. I was tempted to get one and paint it in like a Star Wars colour scheme, like a Star Wars Use Universe civilian or rebel vehicle kind of colour scheme in an Industrial Light and Magic style. Maybe. We'll see. It's a nice kit. It is a nice kit. Good value for money because it's quite complex. Well, not quite complex. Quite big. And it's a meaty build. But you're 40-odd quid. My Storm Wolf was actually sold it, but it is actually, but it's still in my possession, thankfully. It's actually at my local Warhammer store, although I think they keep it in the back room. They don't put it in the cupboard because all their shelves are right in the window, and I think if they put it in the window it just melts because it's like a million degrees. My local Warhammer store. And I actually had the honour of using it to play my first ever any kind of Warhammer game on an open day when they played some kind of silly orc racing game. What it's called now. Like a racing game. You go round and round and you've got like crazy physics and stuff. It was great fun. But all these people in like various vehicles and I'm in a flyer. Yeah, I didn't win. Need to clear my throat. Oh, I tell you, talking for 3 hours kills your throat. Right, welcome to a chat. Look at the popularity, says Timothy. Beamhook Matchmaking Club. There's the Beamhook link for you again. If it worked. Timothy says, I might be the only one in the American Southwest. No, Lynn is in New Mexico. Beamhook Matchmaking Club. My spin wheel will come up error all the time, says Mayhem. Well, thanks for the heads up on the Razor Crest. I just bought one and no intention of messing with it. I'm just going to build it out of the box. Only Imperial armor I'm interested in for my collection right now is a couple of Exorcists. I don't know what they are. I was going to need one of those Paragon war suits. Modeler number 3, if you're a fruit, what type would you be? That's the Boomhut Matchmaking Club. I don't know why I put the Boomhut link in there again, like 2 minutes after I did it last time. Right, so we need to make this gun, which is not described in the description at all. So I've no idea what kind of gun it is. It's a bit, oh, we're going to drill the barrel, wasn't there?
Oh, I wish I hadn't remembered that.
Yeah, I wish. Irony is, you guys have probably forgotten. No.
Did I just... Where's my... Yeah.
Let's see now, how small is this? It's a tiny, tiny little molecular gun of molecules. Even that's far too big. Well, I'm not far too big, but if I miss with that, I'm right screwed. Very well. It'll have to be. I get the feeling Mama Fox is either not going to bother going through the freezer and chosen anything to defrost. By the time I get downstairs, ideally, it needs to be defrosted. Or she'll want fish fingers, in which case it'll be like, oh God, how boring. Fish fingers. After all the food you guys talk about, my chat, or fish fingers, it's just not there, is it? Right, let's see how much we can screw this up. Probably all screwing up will occur. I don't like making these pilot holes because they're never in the middle and they often slip and take your finger out. Let's just whisk it for a biscuit. What's the worst that can happen? Let's not think about the worst that can happen, shall we? Squeaky, squeaky times! Squeaky, squeaky times! See, I just go in balls to the wall. I don't start doing little test pits and I just go straight in and hope I'm in the middle. No, I'm not in the middle, but I can correct that. That's cool. Just need to make sure I'm not going off the edge. Okay, so it's not centered, but we can fix that. I'm not going to drill out the holes in these ones, though, because seriously, I'm not that kind of idiot. I'm not that insane. I can deal with the hole not being in the center. That's fine. What I need it to not do is go off the edge and knacker the side. That's the trick. Drilling, 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 drillity time. That one is a bit better centered, but still not quite. I've not gone off the edge. That's the important bit. The thing is, it doesn't matter how hard you try. You think you're putting the drill bit in the center, and it looks like it's in the center, but it never is. So, how do we make this hole? Can you see that? How do we make this little hole here in the center? You've seen me do it before. Blade. Carve it out. We carve out the rest of the barrel to put it in the center. Not going to be neat, but it's better than the barrel that's not in the middle. Is it better if you get the hole in the middle at the start? Well, absolutely. 99% of the time, that's not going to happen. That's not going to happen. Drill out the barrel. Drill out the barrel of a gun. You see what I did there? Okay, so that looks rough as a badger's arse right now. Same here. This one's kind of at the top, so we're going to try and carve the rest of the barrel to be as thick around the edge as the top half of that. This one's a bit trickier because the top bit is quite thin. It just needs to be good enough. If it's a model that you're going to play on the tabletop, and it's not a display shelf queen, you're not entering it for a competition, and you're not planning on selling it, it doesn't need to be museum quality. It just needs to be good enough to get away with it on the tabletop. Which is why you have like tabletop level paint jobs and then you have professional level paint jobs. That'll do. It's close enough, I think. Good enough for you is good enough for me. Right, so there's Scruffy. Rough as a badger's arse. So you know the trick now. Get yourself your extra thin. Get most of it off. And just very gently run it into the barrel and around the outer edge. It melts away for any of the little fluffy, scruffy bits.
And you end up
a nice drilled out barrel. Once that dries, it'll be smooth as, because it's melting all the little frizzy bits of plastic. And once you've painted it, of course, you'll get a bit of black wash in there. You won't see that it's only like a millimetre or two deep. That's the thing. You have to keep in mind, it's going to get a black wash in there, or a dark wash. Doesn't have to be, actually, several inches deep. We've just got a recess. Yeah, fine. And there you go. That's that done. Yay. Now, I could drill out barrels on these, but these aren't full circles, and it's just asking a bit too much trouble for that. So I'm going to leave them as they are, I think. I think we can leave it like that quite happily. There you go. But it is important when you're doing any kind of project like this, well, with Warhammer stuff, set your expectations. Do you want tabletop quality, or do you want display quality, or do you want, like, are you selling it? If you're selling it, you need to do as much as you can and make the best job you can. If you just want to play it on the tabletop, you've got the luxury of just tabletop quality in it. Which is why you'll see people spend days and days and days painting carefully a lieutenant or a captain, but then when it comes to the grunt troops, they'll just give them a quick paint job because they're just blob troops. Doesn't really matter. Fox, you can't beat a fish finger sarnie. Yeah, I know, but... Timothy says he's looking into one of them Vortex paint mixers because army painter paints he'd need so much damn shaking. You could do that, or you could just try different paints. Unless you've just bought a whole mess of army painters. Yeah, they do work quite well, those devices. I just use little glass beads that I put into my paint bottles and shake the crap out of them. Although I'm an old man now and doing this for like 10 minutes is kind of hard on my elbow. So, yeah. I have one already. Best thing I've bought so far, says Skill Model Muse. Yeah, they are pretty cool. I should get one myself, really. Especially if you've got limited hand and movements, I suppose. Think of it like that way. Yes, it probably is a good thing. I like to carefully make a nick in the middle of each barrels with a new exacto blade, says Timothy. Yeah, I do that, but I end up making a big nick in the side of my thumb. I'm like, try getting a blade and doing that with it, and it goes into my face. I've done that before now. I'm known as Captain Stabbity, so I'm a bit allergic to things with blades, really. Mainly because before I was an Amazon peasant, I was a welder, and making punch mark really helps with keeping a drill where you want it. Yes, a pilot hole or punch mark would be great, but at that scale, because the thing is, when it's like something, especially where there's been a nub on the end of the barrel, you end up with a barrel that it's not square like that. It's like got a curve to it. You end up with like the barrel there, but the top would be curved. When you put the drill bit on, it's like, so yeah. If it's a big enough gun, I can get a pilot hole in the middle. That's perfect. But if it's something small like that, I just wing it. I have a goal with Warhammer, says Timothy. Golden Demon. Yeah. What, not Slayer Sword? He's not around at the minute, Si Reynolds, but our very good friend Simon Reynolds, who we all know and love from the Boom Hut, but he is our actual resident Golden Demon winner twice. He's won a Golden Demon. He's a fantastic painter. And now, he's what you could call an actual professional painter because, A, he's won awards, so he is legitimately an award-winning painter. And he is legitimately a professional painter because he's worked for Games Workshop. No, actually, he wasn't a painter for them, was he? No. He's worked for, I can't remember who he worked for now. Not Games Workshop. He worked for one of the companies as an actual painter, you know, in their paint shop. So, painting the minis. So, there. Yeah. He's actual proper hardcore profesh. Right, this goes on. Just sort your...
Get hot, Fox. What are you doing?
Right, that goes there like that, in there. These go into here like this. You'll see with the ammunition going into... There we go. Ammunition goes in the hole. The rabbit goes in the hole. The fox chases it round. That's the wrong one. Okay, right. Let's just get these things on. Let's get it on. That goes in there like that. I'm not bothered if guns don't pivot and move. I'm not really fussed about that. It may be that when I eventually have enough like space marines to have an army, I might not have any old marines anyway. So it might be that this never actually gets played in a game. But even if it doesn't, I say it was a gift from my brother, but even if it doesn't, it doesn't matter because I can still film how to paint it. And therefore it's made itself useful in that way already. Do 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 beep 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 beep. Yeah, with the not fitting properly. There we go. No, we don't. Yes, we do. No, we... There it is. No, it isn't. Yes, it is. No, it isn't. Och, we're in Baljid Hid. I was hoping I could put the gun on after I've put the... No, it's not going to let me do that, is it? Fine. Fine. There we go. Right, that's that in. Get it bad numpty. Well, they're not going to go anywhere, are they? Wow. They're kind of hardcore attached forever, though. Okay, so they're in. Get that glued down. I'll have it pointing up a little bit, because guns that don't point up are a bit silly. Guns that just point ahead are a bit boring. Except they're both now locked in place, so... I'm pointing up like they're at rest. There we go. It just makes it look a bit more dynamic and interesting. Get them two glued together. Not bothered if they're movable. Okay. Like with the Baneblade and things, you get the turrets and they're all positionable and movable. But it's like, when people play, do they actually really move the guns around on vehicles to point at the targets? That's not part of the gameplay, I don't think. So I know it means if you're making the model, you can put the guns in whatever pose you want, which is cool. But I like the idea. It makes me laugh the people that try to make sure these things are still movable and poseable. It's like, doesn't actually matter, dude, because it doesn't actually matter. This needs to go on there, so we'll get some extra fat glue on here. Flash off otherwise. I like these kind of cowlings and things. As you like, a good word that as well, cowling. I did find with the Storm Wolf, the Storm Fang, the Space Wolves flyer, troop transport, that the cover that goes over the big cannon on the top of the at the back, if you put the cannon on the back, it didn't fit very well and it was a bit wibbly wobbly. I got mine wasn't quite perfectly straight, which was kind of annoying. I'm going to assume these are like twin linked assault Gatling cannons or something. There'll be some awesome Warhammer style name for them. Yeah, that's that done. Always put the lid on the glue. Let's have a look at the chat. Road trip. Good luck, Golden Demon. It's a skill model muse. Yeah, that's the thing. Yeah, absolutely. If you want to set yourself a target as a Golden Demon or even Slayer Sword, do it. I mean, absolutely. Just do it. The only thing that sets a beginner apart from an award-winning painter is that the award-winning painter's been doing it longer. That's it. I've said right from the start. I'm going to put this tape over there. I've said right from the start, and I say it in my channel introduction video, that I believe anyone can do what I do. If we just limit it to my level of skill, which is nowhere near award winning. Oh, I've just got powder everywhere. I've been tipping my sanding dust into my bin bag, but my bin bag's folded over, so it's on the outside of the bin bag. My hoodie's covered in sanding dust. Yeah, I say in my video, anyone can do what I believe that anyone can do what I do with a little guidance. And that's the whole point. Absolute newbie, professional. Only difference, this person's done more things and learned more things and knows how to use the things he's got or she's got. This person hasn't learnt that yet. All this difference is the things that this person knows, things that this person hasn't learned yet or got used to doing. That's it. So if you want to be a Golden Demon, that's your target, do it. You'll be able to get there. You'll get there. Take the time, learn the things, study everybody else's work. Don't worry if you're good enough, if you're as good as somebody else or not. That doesn't matter right now. One day, you'll be able to sit there and say, I am as good as that, but I know I can do better. Just, you know, go with the flow. Take your time, see what happens. Shall I glue this on or shall I leave it off? I might leave it off for painting porpoises. Until I've finished, because I can get to the back of it if it's left off, can't I? If it's on like that and glued in place, I'm like, oh, fiddliness. But this way I can stick it on, I can clamp it and paint it. Clamp it! Because that's that. So yeah, go for it. There is no difference, like I said, literally the only difference between a newbie and an experienced painter is the experienced painter knows things that the newbie hasn't learned yet, and that is it. And if you think about it, All that model making is moving a brush around and wiggling some buttons and applying colour to stuff. Not like some dark thing that only the initiated can learn. Anybody can learn it. It's wrong limits. Anybody can learn it. The practical side of it can be learned by anyone. Oh yeah, burpy little thing. And that's why I do what I do, because I've always believed that. I believed that before I did this channel, I believed that with drawing. And if I hadn't got back into model making, maybe I would have done a drawing channel by now. I would have done an art channel. Probably not, because that's not as interesting to watch or film. But yeah, hey. That. We need the two little lampy bits that go on the front. So go for it. Fill your boots, my friend. Good luck. Also, if you're in the boom hut, and I know Simon Reynolds isn't around at the minute. He's off doing other things right now, so he's not been online for a little while. But when he's back and about, Timothy, if you just ask him in the boom hut, just if you see him in comments and stuff, just ask him. Ask him about what it's like to, you know, what's needed to be a Golden Demon competitor. What the process is and things like that. He'll happily tell you. He was supposed to be sending me I'll tell you what, he was going to take a mould of and send me a copy of his Golden Demon award. He never did. Git. Because then I could have it and say, I've got a Golden Demon! He's not real, but it's a Golden Demon, yeah? I must needle him on that when he's back out and about. That's the only way I'll ever get a Golden Demon. I will happily sit here and say my painting skills are nowhere near that level. Not at all. I'll never be that skill level. I kind of suck at doing glazes for a start, which is kind of a necessary thing, but you know, I could get there in the end. I could learn it. I could develop those skills and master them, but I'm happy where I am. I don't feel, I will do eventually. Where's my knife gone? There it is. I don't feel an urgent need to get to that point because it's not at this time the kind of thing I'm teaching people. I'm teaching people the first steps. The basic steps, the initial get yourself sorted. I'm happy giving people a launching pad that they can jump from and find their own way than telling them how to fly once they're out of the tree. If you go back to my earlier analogy, I get more joy taking someone with no skills at all and giving them some knowledge and ability and watching them go off into the world. There's people in the boom hut now and people I know in real life who 1 or 2 or 3 years ago couldn't have painted, you know, couldn't have painted a dot with a pencil, couldn't have painted a straight line or drawn a straight line with a ruler, and yet now they're painting some fantastic things. Our good friend, you know, me, Dad and Chris and Colin, our good friend Kenneth in Australia, we've known for a few years now, and you know, he had no experience at all when we first met him. Wee, nearly. Is that a wound? Roll for D6 for... no. I rolled a save on that one, I think. I found out later when I clear my airbrush out and there's like a... ooh, close. Yeah, there's no wound there. D6. No wound on that. I was going to make a rolling dice joke, but I can't remember the actual rules for wounds. Yeah, I'll find out later on when I clean my airbrush out, and if there's any alcohol, if there's a little tiny slit in their skin there, it'll get in and sting like a bitch. Yeah, that's how you know. Yeah, so Kenneth, when we first met him, he was like, he had very little experience and didn't really know much about painting and was not really sure what to do. And his skills were, you know, quite simple. But now, he's better than all of us. He's probably one of the best painters I know. Some amazing things. It's story of my life, though. I like to get good at something and then teach people other people how to get better than me. My friend Nikki, who'd never played a first-person game, absolutely sucked Bishop at Halo when I first introduced her to it back in the day. Within 6 months, she was whooping our asses. I'm like, yeah, I've created a monster now, haven't I? Yeah. I get more pleasure setting people up to go and learn than actually teaching advanced stuff. Because A, I don't know the advanced stuff that well. I'm not that good. I don't think I'm good enough at it to teach people. But B, it wouldn't please me as much. It's more fun to watch somebody learning from absolute bare bones beginning stage. Because they've got somebody who's new on the journey has the joy of adventure. You know, they've got the wide-eyed joy of learning things. Whereas somebody who knows what they're doing and is learning an advanced technique, that's not as exciting to watch. They're not as wide-eyed. Like if you've been making models for 25 years and you're really skilled, but say I was teaching you how to do glazing or whatever it was, for example, you wouldn't have that wide-eyed, innocent, fancy about you. You wouldn't be mesmerized. You'd be like, all right, cool, I get it. And you'd go and do it. So there's not as much mileage in that for me. I'd much rather show people from first principles. Does it mean that then it gets a bit boring for people once they've learned and they don't need my stuff anymore? Yeah. But I'd like to think they might keep coming back just for the fun of coming back. You never know. Oh, so much flash on this. Flash! Ah! I'd like to think that once I've taught somebody enough to go off on their own adventure, they might keep coming back just because I'm mildly inoffensive. Ooh, I don't like sounding that bit. Ooh, horrible. I just get more mileage out of it. You know, teaching someone from first principles. In the same way I think, you know, a teacher teaching younger children probably gets more enjoyment out of that than somebody teaching grumpy teenagers because they're teaching them advanced stuff. Whereas, you know, somebody teaching a young child is actually shaping their view of the world, shaping how they see the world and seeing that wide-eyed wonder at things, you know, that grumpy teenagers don't have because they're grumpy teenagers. I get more job satisfaction is what I'm trying to say out of watching the nestlings. Oh, sorry, Guthorn. Sorry, my little friend. My little buddy. More pleasure to be gained. Like explaining the universe to a child in simple terms elicits more of a sense of wonder and amazement and majesty in the child than explaining Lagrange point gravitational physics to a degree student. Because they're just learning the maths, you know what I mean? If that's kind of a silly example, but you get my point. It's revealing the magic, or removing the curtain that makes everybody think this is magic and dark. I'm kind of explaining it really badly. You know what I mean. You know what I mean. More rewarding for me. I always explain things badly when I'm dying for a wee. Right, I think that will do. Anything left we can fix in post-production? Don't know what that means. On a model. These little headlight areas were my area. I shall get these glued in. And then we'll see where we are. 15 minutes to go. Don't need that. You go over there, like that, you see. So these need to go into the little receptacles. Look at the receptacularity. Headlights on the round. Hey, Dad, it's like a 492. It's not like a 492. It's a bit like, it's a little bit. No, it's not really. went to Warhammer World. The ones I've only been to Warhammer World once, a couple of years ago with Chris and Dad and Cy Reynolds, who forgot and didn't turn up. And if you've been to Warhammer World, you know outside there's a rhino, a full size, life size rhino parked outside. Bless him. Dad looked at it. If you don't know, by the way, Dad is Scaly Models in chat. He looked at it and he's like, oh, it's a 492. And it turns out it is. It's a 492 armored transport, armored personnel transporter, done up to look like a rhino. So Dad instantly liked it, even though it was the wrong color, because it was the dreaded blue. Because, you know, Dad used to drive 492s. He's like, oh, it's a 492. Look at that. Oh, yeah. So I can't help looking at, is it 492? I hope I'm getting it right, because I always get the number wrong, and then I sound like a dingus if I say the wrong number, and I sound like a spoon. But I can never look at rhinos and things now and not think of ropey British 1960s, 1970s armour that's only really used in tin pot African dictatorships nowadays. So that goes there, and then this will quite simply plonkate onto here like this, you see. Hopefully we'll line up nicely and nicely. Hopefully we'll, yeah, if you watched Friday's stream, this piece here was warped as F. It was like that. I've never had warped plastic on a Warhammer kit before. So I'm holding out hope that none of these are warped. Oh, there you go. Lovely. Now see, almost, not quite. Yeah, it's a bit. See, I was hoping that if I'd painted the interior, I could have left this removable. I like to leave the tops of like some of these vehicles off because first of all, you can look inside, like the rhinos, you can lift the top off. But also if I'm transporting these, you can put things inside there. Like you can put some of the bits, like I could put that in there and things out of the way so I can take them all off. In my Baneblade right now, all the sponsons are inside the Baneblade to make storage better. So, but that is not really fitting very well. Let's just be perfectly honest about it. So yeah, you'd have to glue it. I mean, I've got to glue it on it because I can't paint the interior now anyway, so it's not exactly the most beautiful of fits. Doesn't quite want to sit, look. I mean, there's supposed to be a gap there, but that doesn't really want to. Yeah, there'll be some gluing in the showers tonight. That'll have to be glued in place. Sadly. No alternative but to glue. And I shall do that. I'll do it now with the taping, and then it's ready for next week. It's actually catching on the tracks. I think that's catching on the tracks. It'll glue down if I tape it. Let me get the tape back. So, what I can do is get some fatness of, I don't want to get too much glue going on because it'll splooge out and make, that's the wrong glue anyway, it'll splooge out and make a mess, but if I get a bit of fatness here, a little bit here, like that, a bit there, just to give it something to anchor to. I appreciate I'm not exactly in shot right now. So that's not in place. Excellent. Brain. There we go. Not in. There we are. In. Right, so that goes on like that. Bit of the glue in there. So what I can do is, I think I might do one end and then the other first. If I run the extra thin down there. I mean, we're not talking a bad fit like that repulsor, dear Lord. But we are talking a little bit shonky going on here. I have to do it in stages, I think, because I can't think I can Don't think I can have everything glued in at the same time. I've got to be careful where I put the tape as well, because I don't want to get the tape going over a bit. I've just glued. That's where you get problems. I think I'll have to go a bit at a time. And slowly, that's not even... No. I'm holding that in place very well. More glue, more tape. You go properly round, that does. Pushing it all the way down, wrapping it round. Tight as you can, my lady. Some serious panel gappage going on there. Oh, yeah. Get a brush in there now. Brush down there. Brush in there. I'm going to have to work my way around. The risk is when you're doing this kind of thing is when you get tape over to hold things in place, the risk that you have is that you get tape over a bit with glue on it. Then you end up with the tape making a mess of the plastic and the glue. And then you get real messy times. You've got to be really careful. I've had that before where you put glue on in a gap and then taped it, and it just comes out like a mess. Let's get that there. I have to accept that there will be some panel gaps, I think. It's not going to be a perfect fit. Now, I'm not glued that side. This bit here, I shall glue at the back. I'm trying to get it in the gap and not along the surface because that's where the tape's going to sit. I just don't want to make too much of a mess. I'll be off camera, I do apologise. And a bit of pushy. Go push that down. There we go, that on that. It's not going to be perfect. I get the feeling there'll still be gaps and nastiness when I get the tape off. I think that's as good as we're going to get. There's a big gap there, but I can't get tape. You can see it there. I can't get tape in there. Now I've done that a bit. May have to fix that later. There'll be some bits sticking up still, probably that I'll have to fix later on. I can get some glue in there. I can do some bits. Some bit. By the nature of both sides being taped at the same time, I will have to accept some panel gap. It may well be that, for example, I do my old trick of the old plastic card strips to hide any really nefarious gaps. That is an option. Just get some glue in these parts for now. Put them on camera. Just to anchor. If nothing else, to anchor things in together. Hopefully, at the end of the day, it'll come good. I mean, if you look at real armoured vehicles and things, there are panel gaps, there are bits, gaps and holes. Dad will tell you. Skelly models will tell you. They're not exactly built to like incredible standards. Even that Rhino on the Warhammer World front has got gaps and holes and everything. That'll do for now. I'll have to leave that for about an hour just to sit and cure. And then when it's done that, I'll take the tape off and I'll see any more gaps I can tweak and glue and work my way around. I know what I can do. I can put some glue down there, actually, while I'm here. Glue here, is it like there, to see? Yeah, a bit of extra grip and binding. Binding on three. Got a click from two. There we go. Let's have a quick last look at chat while that's sat there. Let's see what chat's doing. Hey, where are we up to? It jumped. Mayhem Model Works has carrots. What? What? Orange pointy thing, says Panzer Coat. Wait, well, I'll come back to that in a minute. Oh, wow, I've lost the track there. Here we go. Right, so I want to get to Warhammer World so much, says Raging Modeler. We are planning a road trip again, me, Colin, and Dad, and that lot, those lot. It's probably not going to be 2021. Probably not going to be this year now, I would suspect, possibly. But we will do another one. Because I think we invited everybody last time, but nobody turned up. So we did it last minute. But yeah, I want to go back. I need to save a lot of money. Dad needs to go back and just buy one kit for £400. He went there. He walked in the door. Within 10 minutes, he bought the Orc Stomper. And that was him then, sorted. Wow. And the only reason he bought it is because it was red on the box. The entire reason he bought it, I reckon, is it was red. You don't change your ways at all, do you, Dad? Can't be helped, can you? You and your red things. More glue in there, I think. I'm dreading taking this tape off. I'm going to have big blurbs all around the side. I can see it. See it coming. The tape will impact into the glue and then there'll be like splooge coming out and then, yeah, I can see it coming. Happened before. There's some things you can't sand out. Ah, well, that's where camouflage netting comes in then, you see, because if you make a real mess of it, you just cover it in camouflage netting and nobody can see anything. Yeah, so there will be Warhammer World trips. Warhammer World is great, but take a lot of money. Yeah, the attack on whatever, the big diorama in the main hall, that is an incredible thing to look at. The fall of Rise, or whatever it is, I can't remember what it's called now. There's one thing they do, though, that they don't explain very well. When you go into the store, you walk in the front door and you're right into the store. When you go through the store to the exhibition halls, you see this massive, enormous diorama that's like three-fourths tall. And it's all like thousands and thousands of Space Marines and Titans and all kinds of things. There is in that diorama one single Eversort assassin figure. Looks a bit like the guy from Crisis in black. There is one single assassin in that diorama and they move him around. And the idea is, I think, if I remember rightly, if you find him, you take a picture. If you find him, you tell the guy in the store that you found him and you get a free Eversort assassin figure, I think, and or something like that. But yeah, there's a thing, if you find the assassin in that diorama, you win something. Because he explained it to me. He says, right, when you go in there, but he didn't really make it very clear. And of course, I didn't know what he was talking about because I didn't know what an assassin was or what the diorama was. If you do go there, make sure you have a look for the assassin in that diorama. Trust me, it's like, I couldn't find it. I've set my goal, which is to defend my first place trophy as my local IPSM convention. Good girl. I've had 2 years to work on my project, so I think I have a good shot. Model shows are great to go to near. I miss being able to attend my local one this last year. Yeah, not going to get one this year, I don't think, either. I want to enter another competition, not Golden Demon. No way I'll win that. Just local fun one, like when I enter the Squidzilla tank one. Yeah, I don't do competitions. I don't think I'm anywhere near good enough. I went to my first show in 2019 and was looking forward to going again in 2020. Sadness. Maybe 2021, says Lee. I think we might be pushing it for this year. I think 2022 is going to be, I think, when we start getting back to normal. I think. Just catching up now. La 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 la. I put the box back on the shelf. It was a fire. One model show a year near me. I make an annual thing for me and the kid. Thanks to You Know What last year was cancelled. I'm not sure if we'll go this March. Doubt it. I wouldn't say go this March. We're not going to be anywhere near out of the woods. I don't think you should go to anything this year. Never mind this March. That's what's my world. Thanks, Foxy. I'm really happy my blending has improved in the past month or two, says the Raging Modeler. It has. Your stuff's looking good. Hello. Where's that? I'll get to that chat in a minute. But Wayne Moore just did a super chat. Let me go forward. $5. Slap on.
Hang on. You get free Ted for that. Except my buttons don't work. Hang on. Let me reset my buttons. God damn it. Come on, buttons. Honestly, it's not hard. You were a matron. You just reset me buttons. Hang on a minute. Nope, still not working. 1 second. Oh. You can see the camera wobbling because I'm moving. It's on my desk. Put that down and we'll close that. Close that. Do that. And we'll open that. Wait for that to load and we'll press that. That. Do all of those. God, Stream Deck, you know, you can make your software a little less crunchy. Right now.
There we go.
You get a free Ted. Thank you very much for that, Wayne. You're very, very kind. You crazy fool. You're very, very kind. Thank you very much. I really appreciate that. Where are we up to? Panzer says he doubts anything will happen this year. No, I don't think anything's going to change this year. We're going to be in the same situation we are now, I think. And even if we're not, I would recommend not doing anything this year. Wait till next year. It's not worth the risk. Nim has learned about the wonders of Starship Filth. Filth. You're my favourite background noise, Foxy, says Muse. Oh, I've never been called that before, and I kind of like it. Mayhem is currently in the kitchen chopping carrots and parsnips. Fox went, owie, and I nearly done stabbity myself. Fox, you cleared up a lot of stuff for me watching Warhammer TV do this, and it's steps A to C. You show the B too. Yeah, I hope so. I hope I do. 4-3-2, says Panzer Koenig. Did I say 4 something else? I always get it wrong. Don't say carrots, you will summon Jar Jar blurb. Kajitas the carrots. Ule, the Jar Jar is already here. What is this nonsense? I do not understand this. I want the carrots and things to throw arrows at. Thank you very much. This is not in line with Akatosh. Where are we? Paul Di Tommaso had 2 chicken cup o' noodle and some buttered toast for lunch. Vallejo Liquid Gold set and a few others I couldn't get at the shop, says Muse. Oh, paints for... Oh, yeah, Amazon 5, just delivered. I've ordered some... I ordered some ammo by MIG enamel streaking grimes because I've run out. So I ordered a few on Amazon and it didn't actually say where they're coming from. So now I have a big batch of ammo by MIG washes coming from somewhere in the UK. I have a single jar of streaking grime coming from South Africa. I think it's South Africa. That's going to cost me a fortune. I'm like the bottle itself is like £3.25. I'm going to have about £200 in import duties. And then it said, hey, we've got another one from you. It's coming from the Netherlands. I'm like, oh. Yeah, I'm going to have to start looking carefully where things are coming from now. Like for one bottle of streaking gram, I'm going to pay probably twice the price of it for import. I'm like, oh, God. Assuming it even arrives. Dad is an absolute legend, says Candy Graham. This is true. And a small house for a diorama because I'm lazy and didn't want to scratch build it. Still need to decide on the colours for this random griff hound. Blues and purples. I intend to buy many orc things. I need a jet and vehicles. What, to put the orc things that you buy in? Oh, you mean in the game? Sorry, yes. You need some Dacca jets. You do need some Dacca jet action going on. Because I mean, just... Yeah, I know it's not in shot, and it's just yeah. You need. I'm not trying to say anything, but you need some of that shizzle going on, really. 2022 will just be the world drunk and slumped on the side path. Yes, the photos posted from Warhammer World were just jaw dropping. Sense. That's the thing, though, because if you remember, I posted up a billion photographs of all the stuff at Warhammer World. Next time I go. I can't just post up the same pictures, but it'll be the same stuff, so I don't know what to take photographs of next time.
I've still got my coin somewhere, my Warhammer coin somewhere, I think.
Foxy broke it again. I didn't do nothing. Do you think you've used enough tape, model making guru? Never. Never use enough tape. Time to dish up some dinner, so we'll say ciao. Oh, it's after 6 o'clock. I need to go. A parcel delivered. My birthday can't open yet, says Wendy Hickson. Oh, fail. Still have 2 individual jars of paint on the way too, says Muse. Anyway, it's 6:05, dudes. I didn't even realise that. Sorry I've gone on there too long. Thank you very much for watching. I will be back, of course, tomorrow with the eModels Monday show. I will have the buttons tomorrow on the StreamYard, so expect it to fall over every 5 minutes. Do be patient with us. I'll be back tomorrow with the StreamYard. I will be carrying on with this week, so I won't be working on the Lehman Russ. So expect lots of photographs and updates. When this is finished... I'll make the video available for patrons and members only. It's going over to Goblin. I'm going to make it available as a member and patron exclusive paint job. Don't panic if you're waiting to see me paint one of these. Of course, I do have my tabletop trauma center, one of these I've got to paint as well. So everybody else. So I'll be working on this week. So I expect lots of update photos as I go along. It's my way of motivating myself to get at the bench because then I've got to prove it. I'm doing it by giving you photographs. So if I don't put pictures up, hassle me. But until next time, I shall say thank you very much for watching. Thank you to all who've done the super chats and stuff, and all my lovely patrons and channel members. If you want to become a patron and support the channel or a channel member, you can go to patreon.com/modelmakingguru, or if you prefer, you can become a channel member by pressing the join button underneath any one of my videos. Either way, you'll get access, early access, ad free to a lot of my video content and some other perks as well. So do have a think about it and see if you'd like to help out. Massive thank you to all of them, all the folks that have super chatted tonight. You've paid a lot of bills tonight, so thank you very much. That's it. I'll be back on Monday tomorrow. Don't forget, of course, tonight, Fred is on in, I don't know what time Fred starts, in a bit, in Modelers United, doing his stream. And then, of course, Ted will be back tonight, I'm assuming at 9 o'clock on Skipper Scale Models, with his, I think he's still working on the Hydra. And make sure to go and watch that as well. I'll be in the chat, although I might be spraying. So I might be, although I will watch Ted tonight, I might be spraying and painting. So I might not be active in the chat, but I will be watching. But yeah, take care of yourselves. I shall see you all very soon. I'll post some updates on the Orc Flyer. Until then, I'll make sure my buttons still work.
Slap it on.
Yeah, I thought they didn't work then. It didn't quite trigger straight away. My buttons still work. I shall say thank you very much. Take care of yourselves. Go make something awesome like these. Go be awesome. And until next time. Adios, amoebas. Bye.